remember the sickness was forever. I remember snuff videos. Cold September's, the distances we covered, the fist fights on the beach, the busies round us up. Do it all again next week in embryonic love. The first time that it's scarred, embarrass yourself for someone, crying like a child. And the boy you kicked Tom's head in still bugs me now. That's the thing, it lingers and claws you when you die.
Dr. Hyde Park for what is going to be a memorable and remarkable final. I'm delighted to be joined here beside me by Roscommon and Michael Glavy, senior footballer, and a man who texted me this morning to say that the power was out in Ballinlough. Well, even though his electric shower is not working, he's fresh and clean and ready to go. Conor Hussey, great to have you on board here with Roscommon GAA TV. Look, I'm no connection with either Boyle or Strokestown Club. You've no connection that I know of with either Boyle or Strokestown Club. But this is still a very exciting occasion, and it feels like there's a special event going on here.
Thanks for having me, Kevin. Yeah, I'm delighted to be here and really, really looking forward to this final between, I suppose, two teams who over the last few years wouldn't have been known as one of the bigger powers in the county. So I think it's good for a lot of clubs in the county that these two teams are in the final, and just really looking forward to what's really going to be an intriguing final now.
There's the whole thing about, you know, this is a special occasion for the north of the county, that, like, look, the south has dominated things for so long. Just, I suppose, it happens that the stronger clubs at the moment are all in a little cluster down there. You know, you who has started the last few senior championships with a club hoping to reach this particular stage, you know, is that a thing that you think of? You know, do you feel like, okay, it's very hard breaking into that hegemony, or is that something that plays on your mind? And by that, I mean, would it have played on the minds of these clubs here?
I don't think so, Kevin. I think especially Boyle have been knocking on the door probably a bit more than Strokestown in the last 2 or 3 years. It wouldn't really be a geography issue. I think more just an individual club base, like the likes of my club, Michael Labby's. We always are looking up to the big teams in St. Bridget's and Pearce's and Clonmagale. And I just think it's a case that we have to get up to their team and their level. And I think recently Boyle and Strokestown, to a lesser extent, have probably done that, so they deserve to be here on the day. And I think it's good for general football in Roscommon.
It's great for football in Roscommon. I mean, I know people always talk about, look, regardless of which side wins this, you know, somebody's going to go into a Roscommon senior panel next year. There'll be 4 or 5 lads at least, you know, that'll have county medals in their pockets, which is, you know, winning stuff changes. I mean, you went through that. You won an intermediate title with Michael Glavy's, but more importantly, you went on, you won a Connacht intermediate title. You played in Croke Park after that. You played against some of the best footballers in the country. I mean, the Kavanagh brothers. You know, playing games like that, that must give you a huge boost when you go into a county panel afterwards.
Without a shadow of a doubt, yeah, without a doubt. And I'm sure there'll be many players on display here today that will be involved in the new Roscommon senior team for the next year. So that'll be very interesting to see too who breaks into that.
Absolutely. Well, we'll start here. We're going to take you through the route to the finals of the two clubs so far. Now, it's been very, very different for the two clubs here, that have come in. I mean, for Boyle, it has been plain sailing, 5 wins out of 5. No huge hiccups, you would say. They just fell over the line maybe a little bit in their second group game, albeit that was with Dara Craig. He caused them a good few problems in the quarterfinals as well, but they eventually had 5 points to spare. Bit different for Strokestown. Strokestown, I mean, got out of the group with 1 draw and 2 defeats, you know, but really found their form after that. Like, would that, if you were stroke sound, would you say to yourself, okay, we're not quite in as good form, or would you say, look, we're hitting form at the right time? You know, is there any kind of pointers, if you like, as to how the two clubs are fixed in that route to the final there in front of us?
I think probably Boyle would be overall more happy with their route to the final in terms of the results. They were very consistent throughout the entire campaign. They won all their games, whereas Strokestown have more or less hit form in the last month or so. But I don't think that's going to worry Strokestown one bit. I think it's on the day here. They know that, and I know for a fact that Strokestown, although Boyle are favourites, probably Strokestown will not fear Boyle today. So the path, I think, is largely irrelevant. But just out of an interesting point is that I didn't see a lot of these teams' games this year, but I did see the Strokestown versus Tulls game in the round two in Tyrone Barry, which is a really, really interesting game and a very enjoyable game. And actually, Tulls had a really good chance towards the end of that game to win that game. Mm. And should that result gone that way, it could be a vastly different outlook for Strokestown this year. So it just shows you that the small margins play a big role, and Strokestown could really benefit from a little bit of luck that day. So very interesting.
There you go. If Eugene had it set up here beside us now, we'd have the Aqua Music Turn Back Time. I think, wasn't that the theme tune to Sliding Doors? That was the famous what could have been different. I mean, there's, to me, the turning point with Strokestown, which I was here for, was the quarter final against Orne. 15 minutes into the second half there, Orne are ahead by 2 points. Strokestown have just been reduced to 14 men. Like, for a club like Strokestown that had been very, very competitive in a lot of games like that, but had struggled to win them. I mean, that must be absolutely transformative, you know, to find a way to win that game and win it so decisively in the end.
Without a doubt, yeah. I think you have to remember that Strokestown are around senior football for a long, long time. They have a lot of experienced players. Orne had a fantastic year this year, but probably it's fair to say they might have the same level of experience as Strokestown. And I know for a fact, too, that Strokestown weren't fearful of Orne that day, and that they were 100% going into that game focusing on winning that game. And that's what they did, and I suppose I know Cahal Compton got sent off with 15-20 minutes to go that day, and that was just before our own quarterfinal. And I thought that Orne would push on that day, but it just shows you that Strokestown, they're very hard to beat, and they'll stay there to the final moment. So I think that'll be in the Boyle's mind today too, that Strokestown will not give up no matter what.
At the risk of dredging up scars or anything like that, your reflections on your own quarterfinal against Boyle, like, do you feel, you know, you were like that hugely competitive for long stretches? There was no stage really until the final whistle where you would say the result was completely secure. You know, would you feel like, geez, if we got them again tomorrow, we'd be close enough to them? Or, you know, was it just a one-off performance? Do you think maybe Boyle didn't show their full hand that day? What was your interpretation?
I think overall, I suppose, I was happy enough with their own performance on that day. But the result was obviously unfortunate, but we were massive underdogs coming into that game that day, and we had chance to win it, but I suppose ultimately we weren't probably just good enough to take the chance on the day. And I think Boyle were deserved winners when it came to it. When it came to the last 5-10 minutes, they took their scores, and overall, look, we were close, but we were unfortunately not close enough. So we can have no complaints. Boyle were the better team probably overall in the day, and they deserve to be, I suppose, where they are at the moment.
Yeah. Well, now obviously Roscommon GAA TV has been with you the whole way through this championship season. There's been a lot of games featuring both these teams that have been played. We're going to take you through some of the highlight footage at the moment of some of the games. I mean, right from the start, we had Strokestown. I was there for Strokestown's game against St. Bridget's. We were there for all the quarterfinals, all the semi-finals, Boyle's game against Clons. We'll just take you through some of the key moments that have brought these two teams to this famous county final Sunday here at Dr. Hyde Park. Finds McGann. Will he just square up and Sheehy and go at him? He will. Looks to cut inside. Ronan Stack is there as well. Great burst of pace by McGann. What a goal by Dearman McGann. Ball inside. Colin Compton hasn't got his name on the score sheet yet. Will he do it this time with the left foot? He will. Phenomenal. Lovely diagonal ball. And there you go. Fantastic finish for Dara Craig. And Craig brings his tap, and Colin Gold was definitely not happy. He felt it should have gone to him. It goes through to Dara Craig, however, and Dara Craig.
That was Kieran Regan. Strokestown into the centre. Chance for Strokestown. Oh, what a goal! In towards McGann. Oh, and McGann has got in inside his man. Dearman McGann through. Is he going to go around the keeper? A goal for Strokestown! Strokestown are in the semi-final. Here comes Cahal Bailey. Left footer from Cahal Bailey. Oh, that's a great pass inside. Lovely pass inside. And here comes Dara Craig. Dara Craig, left footer from Dara Craig. Over the bar. Good day. Evan McGrath. Right footer from Evan McGrath in towards the centre. And it's snapped up. Oh, it's snapped up. It's here. pace this man has. Taking a lot of steps. That's where it opens up. There's a chance of a goal here. This is Colin Leary. Can he control it? His shot. It's in the back of the net. What a goal by Strokestown. And Leary get the ball out of there. And he cleared lines. And Strokestown have overturned it. And it all came from sloppy play by the defence. Paddy Brogan takes the shot from way out. And it's in the net. What a goal. And it all came.
Wins the free. Tyke McKenna. And Tyke McKenna in towards Keane McKeown. Fists it in towards the centre. This is good play from the Boyle men. Jarrett Craig over the bar. Enda has it. Four to hand from Enda. And Joni is going to have a go from far out the field. Is that a good score?
Okay, so we've seen there what brought the two teams to this final so far. I mean, to look in particular at the two semi-final victories, that was the real coming of age for both of them. Strokestown took on a Roscommon Gael side that was on a high after beating Pádraig Pearse's. They rode the wave, they came through that second goal we saw there, that fantastic goal from Paddy Brogan. And Boyle equally made a slow start against St. Bridget's, built back into it. So both sides will certainly feel they're coming into it emphatically. They didn't fall over the line in the semi-final. They emphatically made their way here.
Yeah, without a shadow of a doubt, yeah. And I know Strokestown got stuck into Roscommon Gaels that day in particular, and they were full credit for their victory. But at the same time, that semi-final victory for Boyle, I suppose, can't be underestimated how much that will do for their confidence, especially beating a team like St. Bridget's, who are hotly tipped this year. So again, it's hard to know which semi-final will have the greater impact, but again, it's all on the day today, and it'll be interesting to see how the game goes.
We'll take you through the team lineups here now, and we'll start with the Strokestown team, where we have been told there's one change to the side that you're going to see on your screen in front of you. That change is number 17, Cathal Brogan, comes in to replace Kevin Finn, who we believe injury has ruled him out, apparently sustained an injury in that semi-final win over Roscommon Gaels. That's a hugely significant one. Kevin Finn, hard-working winging forward, able to chip in with scores, you know, experienced player, been knocking around the best part of the last decade. So that is a blow for Strokestown.
That's a massive blow for Strokestown, yeah. Very unfortunate for Kevin. He's had a few injury issues down through the years, and I'm actually very disappointed for him because he'd be one of the hardest working players out there today. And I suppose the work rate and the tackling that he offers Strokestown is invaluable. And I suppose even if you see Paddy Brogan's goal in the semi-final, I think it's Kevin Finn that makes the tackle on Roscommon Gaels' goalkeeper.
Yeah.
And that just shows you what he's all about. So I'm really just disappointed for Kevin, but hopefully Strokestown will have an able deputy in this place today.
Yeah, so Cathal Brogan is the man who steps in. He'll come in. Cathal made his first start of the year in that game against Roscommon Gaels. On that occasion, he was also in on account of injury. It was Kieran Regan who was injured for that game. Kieran Regan, happily, is able to take his place here this afternoon. Regan, who, of course, got that famous goal, brilliant goal, to really turn the tide of that Oran game. Had kicked 2 points in the previous round against Pádraig Pearse's as well. He made his debut last year, got a fantastic goal against Clonagh Gaels. So, you know, getting him back is obviously a huge boost on the Strokestown side. The Boyle team is exactly as it's shown on your screen in front of you here now in a second. Boyle continue with the exact same side that started, and it's been an incredibly settled team for Boyle all year long. Dara Craig missed the second round game, their narrow win on that occasion against St. Foyle's. Oisín Craig has been injured, all right. He played the first couple of games and has been injured ever since. But other than that, it's been a very, very consistent team. No real changes to the side over the last rounds. Eden Kearns came in for the semi-final, all right. But other than that, very, very consistent selection the whole way through. Keane Smith knows what his best team is. You know. So we'll go through a couple of key players that you've picked out who are going to be we feel that could make a significant contribution today. The two men you want to talk about, we're talking about Sean Maloney from Strokestown. Obviously, you can take us through who you think. You know, there's a lot of key forwards on that Boyle side that he's going to need to be picked up. Sean Maloney's going to have one of those marking jobs. And then Enda Smith, who I think it's fair to say Enda has been hampered by injury so far. And then there's the question, look, you know, Boyle, he didn't make a huge contribution to their semi-final win, but obviously they need him to step up here this afternoon.
Yeah, there's a lot of key players on both teams that we could have focused on, but I suppose I just chose these two players because I believe that their performance is kind of a major impact on the result of this game. So I suppose both players have been kind of affected by injuries the last few months, and I know Inda was carrying an injury into the club season, and Sean had a few big injuries the last couple of years, and he only returned to the Strokestown panel there a couple of months ago. Just in relation to Sean, when he's on his day, when he's fit, fully fit, you won't find many players that have his athletic ability, such powerful and strong runner. And without a doubt, I'm sure he'll have one of the main and key man marking jobs today, and it'll just be very interesting to see who he picks up. Initially, I suppose, I think that he probably will pick up either Derek Craig closer to goal or possibly Donny Smith. But I think also Shawnee has a big role to play in bringing the ball out for Strokestown. If Boyle push up and they kind of try to tackle high up the field, Sean has the ability to carry the ball, give little 1-2s, and before you know it, he's brought the ball 60, 70 yards up the field, and that'll be master for Strokestown. In relation to Inda then and Boyle, there's no doubt about it. On his day, Inda is a match winner for Boyle, and I suppose I think there's two main areas of the game where Inda could play a vital role. The first one would be the midfield battle, or indeed the aerial battle. If Strokestown try to push up on the Boyle kick-out and Rob Kearney has the ability to find Inda, if Inda can win clean possession, he can really feed those dangerous Boyle forwards, which could have a major impact in the game. And I suppose the second one, and Inda probably would say himself that he hasn't been at his best the last few games, would be the creation of goal chances. Similar to Maluli, when Inda gets up to full pace, when he's running full pace, he's very, very hard to stop. So if Inda can get little 1-2s with Keane McKeown and Donny Smith, he has the ability to create goal chances, which could be massive on a day like today.
Absolutely. I was looking as well, another big aspect to Enda Smith in particular for me is that there was no question in that semi-final game between Strokestown and Roscommon Gaels that Cathal Compton's influence at midfield was absolutely huge. So are you looking at that kind of as a direct matchup there today, or are you looking at maybe Rock Hanmore being the more defensive player might pick up Cathal, whereas David Butler, again, being the more defensive Strokestown guy, would pick up Enda? Which way do you see that going?
It's very hard to know, I suppose. Conditions might come into it small bit, because I know for the under 20 game previously, the underfoot conditions are very, very slippery. So you'd imagine that Rock Hanmore would probably pick up David Butler, which would leave Cathal Compton man marking Enda Smith from the kick out. Although Boyle didn't tend to drop Evan McGrath back around the middle of the field too, so he can be quite good in the air and cause a lot of issues. So it's quite hard to know. Initial calls to me that Cathal Compton would probably go on Inda for the kick-outs, and then maybe in play, it's hard to know then. Strokes might have someone detailed to mark in down play then.
Absolutely. We're just going to give you an opportunity here now for anyone who's casting this broadcast to their TV. There should be a QR code appearing on your screen in front of you. If you scan that, you can download the match programme today. I'd like to pay tribute to John O'Connor, Roscommon County Board PRO. He's put together a fantastic 80-page match programme, and I don't say that because I've written a couple of the articles in it. Absolutely not. Fantastic work from John O'Connor there. It really is. It's a top-class production, and it's well worth downloading. So if you scan that QR code that should be on your TV screen, that's if you're casting. Now, obviously, you could scan it from your phone as well, but that might take you away from this broadcast. So in that instance, we would say you can visit. There's a particular URL, which is bit.ly/RossGAFinal22. That's bit.ly/RossGAFinal22, and you'll be able to download that program either. And I strongly recommend that you do, because there's some fantastic content in it. It made my life an awful lot easier, because a lot of the research work was already done in advance of this final, which was absolutely ideal. So just in terms of other aspects that we're looking at here this afternoon, I'd like to take through a couple of the other maybe matchups that you're looking at that could be significant. Look, obviously, if you're preparing to take on this Boyle team, it all starts from that full forward line: McKeown, Craig, Donny Smith. So, you know, put yourself in John Rogers' shoes for a moment. You already said you're saying Sean Maloney, probably a toss-up between taking on Derek Craig, who'll be closest to goal, or Donny Smith. So put your neck on the line. What way would you line them out of Strokestown's key defenders?
Yeah, I think there's a few matchups here that will have an absolutely massive impact in this game. In terms of the Strokestown defence, I'm thinking that possibly Sean Maloney will man-mark Derek Craig, who's a bit closer to goal. And that would leave possibly David Neary to take Donny, who's maybe a little bit in front of Derek Craig. And then further out the field, I'd imagine that I think he McKeown might be on the 40. and that would leave someone like Colm Nearie to kind of man Markeen tightly, but also to have an impact on the game going forward. It's fair to say though that it's not only those matchups that are going to have a big impact. Strokestown have some very, very good forwards too that are going to take a lot of looking at. In terms of close to goal for Strokestown, they'll have Jerben McGann full forward, and it'll be very interesting to see who picks him up. It probably looks like that could be a job for Conor Flanagan, but I'm sure Sean Purcell will be kind of coming back from his sixth position to do a bit of sweeping, and he will probably help out Conor with Jerben McGann. And then it looks like Colin Compton will probably play on the 42, so it's interesting then to see who do Boyle put man marking Colin Compton. Will they leave Sean Purcell on him, which could take away from their sweeper kind of system, or would they possibly put someone like Ty McKinnon on him? So I think they're the kind of five key matchups that will probably go a long way to deciding this game today, and we'll keep you updated on those as the game comes.
Absolutely. Dermot McGann for me has been fascinating, because I think, you know, obviously he was part of the Roscommon panel, and it's fair to say like he sustained an injury after the Cork match in the first round of the Allianz League. Didn't really get a great run at it. He made the point to me in the press night. He said, look, honoured to play for Roscommon and would play wherever he's picked. Having said that, I think it's fair to say that the kind of inside forward role, where he has a little bit more freedom, suits him a lot more than the wing forward role he was playing with the county. And what he has done as well, it has allowed Shane McGinley to be the guy closest to goal. So you're looking at, you know, you could find two players with a key role, two very young players, Shane McGinley and Daniel Casey. Daniel Casey, of course, still in Abbey Community College at the moment. Shane McGinley, first year out of minor. There's a lot of talk about the whole thing about should we move the age about minor. I mean, if we did move the age to under 18, neither Colm Nearie nor Shane McGinley would be able to play here this afternoon. And they're certainly a strong case for leaving it at under 17, because they've certainly proved that they are more than old enough to hold their own among adult footballers.
Yeah, without a doubt. I haven't had a chance to see Shane McGinley too often recently, but I saw a little bit of him against Orr on that day in the quarter final. I was very, very impressed with him. His movement is very good, and his ball winning ability too is massive, so he could take a little bit of pressure off McGann. But just going back to Jerben McGann, I suppose one of his main strengths is his directness, and when he's, again, similar to Sean Maloney, similar to Enda Smith, when he gets up running, when he's at full bore, he's incredibly hard to stop, and that'll be interesting to see how Boyle do cope with him today.
Well, for me, like that, he has been absolutely key. I mean, you look at it the whole way through the championship. A goal and six against St. Bridget's in the first round, 7 points against Tulsk, 2 points against Pearce's, a goal and three against Oran, 2 points against Roscommon Gaels. That's incredibly consistent scoring. He's absolutely the anchor around which this attack is built. You know, and he is, look, he's a player now, he's now into his mid-20s, obviously hugely promising minor footballer. He was part of the Roscommon minor team that lost an Ireland semi-final to Tyrone back, I'm going to say that was 2013, but I'm not sure off the top of my head. But, you know, and was the leading guy in that team with Dermot Murtagh in the full forward line alongside him. Injuries meant he never really got a run, but in the last 2 years, like this season and last season, his form has been incredible.
Yeah, without a doubt. I'm not surprised, because look, the dedication he has, I suppose, to the game too, and he's a player who loves the gym, loves looking after himself. He minds himself very, very well, and hopefully he has a big game today. Just very interesting to see too the positioning of Colin Compton. I know he's named at number 14, but I probably expect him to play a bit further away from goal. But if I was, say, for example, Keane Smith's position, I might not like to see him that bit closer to goal, because he's very dangerous too on his day, and he has the ability to be a match winner too on his day. So those three forwards you're looking at, say, Colin Compton, Jerben McGann, Shane McGinley, they can equally pose a lot of danger too for Boyle, just as much as the big three Boyle have up front too for Strokestown.
Yeah, well, I want to pick up on that actually, and I'd be curious if this came up in your preparations for that quarter final, because during the group stages, Boyle, obviously very, very impressive, won three games quite well. But I noticed that both St. Fáilea's to a lesser extent, and certainly Clann, when they brought on Cathal Shine after half time, they got a little bit of joy with just old fashioned long ball. Now, look, no team is going to play long ball 4 out of 5 attacks or anything like that, but having that option is crucial, and that's where Colin Compton could come into it.
Without a doubt, yeah. I think the game has actually changed a small bit in that way. You've seen probably Dublin in the last few years, they're not afraid to let the ball in long, Tyrone without a shadow of a doubt. And even I know Cork Pearse's, their success in the last 2 or 3 years, they're very, very good at hitting kind of long balls into like Hubert Darcy and Paul Carey. But just something interesting I noted in the quarter final against Michael Glavies was Boyle are not afraid to let the ball into Derek Craig when he's on the edge of the square. For a young player, he's actually very, very good in the air, so that could be something that would be very interesting to see today too. But again, does that come back down to Maloney? That would suit Maloney, so it's a really big part of the game, and we'll be interested to see how it goes.
So the volume of the crowd rising up here as the Castlereagh Brass and Reed Band lead the two teams around in front of the main stand. Strokestown have broken away. Boyle continuing to follow the band around for the parade. That's one of those things where hindsight is 20-20. If Strokestown win the match after, people will say they weren't interested in the formalities, they were into the football. If Boyle win afterwards, they'll say they had that extra little bit of focus and concentration. History is written by the winners, I suppose.
Yeah, I can only imagine how both teams would be quite nervous this moment in time, their first final in a long, long time, and just trying to put myself in their position here. So,
that's the other thing, like, is that you talk about the preparation in terms of a game like this. You talk about the build-up. Obviously, the two towns, they're two strong football towns. They have a massive interest in their local GA club. So, like, it would be impossible if you were living in the area, and obviously not all these players are living in the area, but it would be impossible if you're living in the area not to get swept up by it.
No doubt, yeah. Nerves always play a major role in players' performance. I think just all 30 players starting out here, we're just focused on not letting the game pass them by, trying to get their first touch in and change from there.
So we're going to pause now for Auron na Bhfian, which this afternoon will be sung by Natalie Flanagan of Tulsk. So there's the roar of the crowd. Whether you're tuned in to us in the town of Boyle, in the town of Strokestown, anywhere else around Roscommon, anywhere else around Ireland, or anywhere else around the world, this is the moment we've all been waiting for. We've about 2 minutes to the throw-in here now, and you can feel the tension here in Dr. Hyde Park. Thankfully, we had an absolute downpour this morning all across the county. Like I said, power outage in West Roscommon, flooding on the roads as I was coming in from South Roscommon, but it has cleared up nicely here now. The pitch looks like it's holding up well, so it looks like we're going to get the kind of high tempo open game of football that we all hope for.
Yeah, there's some interesting positions here from the throw-in too. So Evan McGrath has gone to midfield for the throw-in. Inna Smith is actually currently playing left half back from the throw-in, and the big three Boyle forwards have all gone straight inside. So we're just looking here to see now who marks who. And yeah, Sean Purcell is also starting number 11 with wearing six on his back.
Yeah, so I see Maluli coming out here to the right corner. Looks like he is going to pick up Dara Craig, as you thought.
It's actually Maluli and McKeown. David Neary is gone full back on Donny Smith, and number 2, Timmy Gibbons, looks like he's picking up Dara Craig.
Absolutely, my apologies. I read the numbers wrong, which is a shocking sign for a commentator. That doesn't bode well, but look, hopefully that'll be the last time that happens this afternoon. Now, I will say Evan McGrath has gone in for all the throw-ins so far for Boyle, so we'll see how that works. That has been something that they've done each time, whether it is that he has the basketball-esque spring or something to get up off the ground for this one remains to be seen. Referee Oliver Kelly, he's making sure all the players ready to go on either end. I see equally Dermot McGann actually come out to centre forward for the throw-in at the moment. I don't anticipate that that'll continue.
Yeah, Jeremy McGann currently centre forward. Looks like Tyg McKinnon, I think, is it? Yeah.
And the ball is up straight away. David Butler and Rock Hanmore fighting for it, but it's broken out here. Cathal Compton still not controlled. Now, ball in from Cathal Feely, but that's well covered on the Strokestown side. Really well done there by Sean Maluli. Strokestown have possession, but they're under pressure here. Boyle have won it back. Ian McKeown now in possession. The man they call the Bull driving into the tackle. Oliver Kelly says you were driving in illegally, over-carrying, and it's a free out, and it's a free out here for Strokestown. So a high-tempo start as Cathal Compton chips that free back to David Neary, and now Strokestown with their first meaningful possession get that ball out here to Colm Neary, and he'll try and carry the ball forward. There's a little first loss of footing out there on the middle of the field, but thankfully he gets his hand pass away before Cathal Feely can get in and steal possession. Chance now here for Kieran Regan, works the ball forward into Colin Compton, but the hand pass is down to feet. Compton had to go down and win it, and we've had a couple of turnovers. So first two attacks ended in turnovers, a little bit of nerves maybe?
Yeah, I think so. Strokes will be very disappointed with that, because they actually started the game so well. They got a great turnover in Keane McEwen, but so far their tackle has been very, very intense, and here they go again.
Yeah, two Boyle possessions, two turnovers, one Strokestown possession, one turnover. So we'll see who'll be the first to be able to convert this into a goal chance. Colm Neary carrying the ball, or into a scoring chance, I should say. And Dermot McGann, continuing to play quite deep, comes out and picks up this ball some 55 metres from his own goal. Quick exchange of hand passes. Now, this is the Dermot McGann we're used to seeing. Driving forward at pace, shot off his right foot, but he was off balance as he shot, and that's the first wide of the game. So that would be a different way of going about it if he was maybe taking possession from deeper positions and running at them that way.
Yeah, that was a fantastic run from Jermer there. And just one small interesting point is that Sean Purcell's gone back. Well, it looks like he's sweeping for Boyle from number 11 position, which frees up Colm Neary, who's also playing a sweeping role too. You can see him going back towards Darragh Craig.
So we'll have an extra man in defence at both ends of the field. Sean Purcell, of course, still the heartbeat of this team. Brilliant turnover there from Strokestown. Keith Murphy wins that ball, looking for Shane McGinley. McGinley gets out in front, trying to take on Daniel Casey. McGinley onto his right foot. That was an ambitious shot, but I'd say there was a bit of a block on that. Actually, it looks like there was an advantage being played. And Oliver Kelly of St. Fáilea's decides that that's going to be a free in for Strokestown, and a left-footed free, so you'd imagine that'll be Colin Compton country.
I think if Boyle thought they were going to have an easy day at county final, they're straight away, they know that's not true. That's three incredible turnovers from Strokestown early on in the game, and like, I can't tell you as a player, especially defender too, how much that gives a lift to the team. So Strokestown hoping Colin Compton can slot this over now.
Identity of this Strokestown team. Instead, he goes short, looks for Dermot McGann. The layoff hand pass wasn't there. He has to turn in onto his left. Can't get the shot away. Good defensive work there by Luke Glennon. Luke Glennon realised that he couldn't dive in, or else Dermot McGann would be gone by him. Luke Glennon, of course, a keen skateboarder, so he knows all about balance and keeping his feet. Now it's ball forward for Donny Smith. Donny with the left-footed shot. Hangs up that kick, and we have a score here in this Roscommon Senior Football Final. We have 3 minutes gone, and it is Donny Smith who puts that ball between the posts. And there's nothing like that as a forward. Your first possession, three steps, bang over the bar.
Yeah, incredible pass from Minda there. 50-yard pass outside the right boot.
So both Boyle's talisman, if you like, should that be the plural of talisman? Talisman? There you go. One for the graphics, one for the grammatical people among you. Feel free to get in touch and let us know. Strokestown retain possession off their own kick-out. David Butler now. David Butler carrying the ball forward, faced up by Rock Hanmore. Ball recycled across the middle third here. Boyle have plenty of players back. Sean Purcell, as you say, sweeping in front. Shane McGinley and Dermot McGann there. Dermot McGann now being picked up by Luke Glennon. Colm Neary carrying the ball forward here. Recycles it back towards Cathal Compton. Compton tries to burst past Evan McGrath. That's a really good run by Malooly. Oh, lovely layoff as well. And a possible pull of the foot there on Paddy Brogan. I think we're coming back for the original free, however. And we have the two men are down hurt there. It was a lovely, lovely layoff. And we'll just see who the treatment is coming in for here now in a second.
I think it could be Sean Malooly on the Strokestown side.
Well, Sean Malooly was the man carrying the ball forward, and it looks like Sean Purcell is the man down. So two absolutely vital players for their respective clubs. That was exactly what you were talking about with Sean Malooly. When he gets the chance, gets a little bit of open country, he has that burst of pace.
That's his second run too in the game. That's something that he's capable of all day long too, so he started in really, really good fashion.
So we're looking at the possibility of a blood substitution here now, or a temporary substitution. We'll see now in a minute who's there's players warming up on both sides. So Sean Purcell is being sent to the sideline, and straight away we see that Eden Kearns is coming in. So another Abbey Community College student. He's coming in. We have just 5 minutes on the clock here. So it's a little bit of a mental change. It's a change of pace mentally. If you're a substitute, you might tune yourself into, okay, I'm going to watch this game for the first 30, 45 minutes, see what's going on in the area where I'm likely to come on. you know, it's a sudden change of gear. You might burn your clutch out coming in after 5 minutes. Like,
it can be very, very hard to come on like that, especially this early in the game, but I'm sure Sean Preston will be back soon enough. Just interesting enough that early enough, it looks like Strokestown are running a lot of the ball, with like Sean Maloney, Jerry McGann coming out running the ball hard, whereas Boyle are looking for kind of early kick passes into their forwards. And just at the moment, Keane McKeown looks like he's playing centre forward, being marked by Sean Maloney.
Free has been slotted over there by Dermot McGann, and look, Strokestown, you see there that run of the ball, it yielded a scoring chance, it yielded their first point of the game, so they'll keep going if that's what works. Long kick out from Rob Kearney, breaks on the Boyle side, Enda Smith chasing it down, looks to dribble the ball along the ground, he's got about 35 yards out, but good cover there on the Strokestown side. Keith Murphy got back to clean up the loose pieces. Lavin with the long ball now, feeds it into Dermot McGann, has two men on him. Killian Cox is coming back to cover. Killian Cox, of course, would have been cornerback in the Boyle team over the last couple of seasons, been transformed into a half forward this year. All the scoring, of course, really not really coming from the half forward line this year in the Boyle side. Carl Feely with 2 points all season, Evan McGrath with one, and Killian Cox yet to score. Ball worked forward here now towards Kieran Regan. We know Kieran Regan can score, but plenty of Boyle players back. Strokestown decide, no, we're going to reset, we're going to recycle, and we're going to try and redo this. It's now in the absence of Sean Purcell, Killian Cox taking up the position of sweeper, and Enda Smith is there on the edge of the D as well. So Strokestown, they have a lot of extra Boyle bodies to look at and see how are they going to pick their way through them. Again, Maloney with the run here, works that ball across towards Brogan, but it's intercepted. Donny Smith coming in back to cover. Donny Smith looks for the long ball towards Derek Craig, but can't win it at the first attempt. And you'd have to say Strokestown's full back line, I know Donny Smith got the first point and kicked it well, but in general, Strokestown's last line of defence holding up really well.
Yeah, Derek Craig was a little bit isolated there. Probably Donny just didn't put it enough in the pass. But Strokestown can be no happier really with their start and defence. They're really, really pushed up on the Boyle forwards. And just Sean Maloney's growing into the game an awful lot here. Now he made another run there that time. But Boyle are getting a lot of men back at the moment, and they're actually only leaving up at the moment. They're switching between Donny and Derek Craig.
So it's one man forward. Colin Compton feeds that ball onwards towards Kieran Regan. Outside of the boot from Kieran Regan. Well, look, this is the showpiece occasion for a Scommon club football, and that is a score worthy of an occasion like it. Kieran Regan, we've said before, he's capable of brilliant scores. That crucial goal against Oran a couple of points before it, I'll tell you, Boyle will have to respect the threat if he's capable of doing that.
Yeah, incredible strike there by Regan.
Boyle carrying this ball out now. Enda Smith in possession. Decides doesn't want to give the long ball. Forced to take the ball. Or not even Enda Smith, my apologies. Tadhg McKenna takes the ball into the tackle. Feeds that ball down now, and it's handled on the ground. So while Donny Smith has settled into the game, the two corner forwards, Craig and McKeown, will probably feel like they wouldn't mind getting even a handy possession. Doesn't even need to be a score, but just something just to settle themselves into this game.
Yeah, after the first 8 minutes now, it's Rose, I'm being much happier, but still only a point up. Colm Neary coming here again now.
Colm Neary driving again, as he did so often. I'll tell you, it's not just, what amazes me about him as an 18-year-old, it's not just the physicality, but it's the conditioning as well. As Boyle on a fast break here now, Enda Smith carrying the forward. Rock Hanmore is available on his left. Back to Smith. There's an overlapping run from Dylan East. Enda Smith shoots himself. Enda Smith off the left. And there you go. We talked about how Enda Smith, injury had hampered him in the previous game. Didn't really look, hadn't really dominated the game against St. Bridget's in the semi-final. Well, there's some start, an assist and a point to get going.
Yeah, that'll give Enda an awful lot of confidence. It appears at the moment Boyle are happy enough to play a bit of a counter-attacking game, and Strokestown need to be very, very careful bringing that ball towards the Boyle defensive line, because as they can just see there, when they turn it over, it can be very, very dangerous. But Enda will be delighted with that score.
We've also had a reversal of the blood sub there. Sean Purcell comes back on wearing number 23, but he has a distinctive bandage on his head now, so he'll be easily identified. And Strokestown again go for the short kick out, retain possession, but all 15 Boyle players in front of them, they force a poor pass and a turnover. Tadhg McKenna gets in to win that. Ball work forward here now towards Cathal Feely. Cathal Feely is capable of shooting from distance. Did a couple of times for his Scammon under 20s this year. Ball across towards Donny Smith. Donny Smith now out towards Derek Craig. Derek Craig being squared up here by their Scammon defenders, or the Strokestown defender, I should say, is Timmy Gibbons. We're back out to Rock Hanmore. Hanmore won't shoot from distance. Derek Craig hoists it in. He's looking. Cathal Feely is the man in behind. Little bit of pulling and dragging. Possible penalty shout here. No, not given. I thought Ollie Kelly was going to go and give the penalty. It looked to me like he was going to react there. It was Carl Brogan who was in grappling with Cathal Feely. and it looked for me like it could have been a penalty shout.
I'm not sure how Cathal Feely got his hands in that ball, to be honest.
We'll look at it here again. The high ball came in from Darragh Craig. It broke between Feely. Nothing conclusive there. You'd say that. You'd say, look, county final, it could have been given. I've seen them given, but equally, probably on balance, maybe the right call from Kelly there.
I think so, Kevin. Yeah.
So good reprieve and a good shout, a good start. Oliver Kelly, of course, one of the most experienced officials on the go in Roscommon, refereed the 2008 county final. He's back on the big stage here now this afternoon, and you'd have to say the first big call, the first big test for him today, he's got it right. The 45 comes in from Cathal Feely. Feely, it's a good looking strike, and it's straight between the posts.
Just watch the Boyle press here now.
And
so
Boyle,
it looks like Boyle are putting.
So we have a line of four, a line of three, and then four in midfield.
They don't want Strokestown to get an easy short here.
So Strokestown bursting out of a cluster, trying to cause confusion. He's going out towards the left wing. He's looking for long. Cathal Compton is underneath, but there's a little bit of a push in the back. The push came from David Butler, who was coming from a deeper position. Sean Purcell chips that ball forward in towards Darragh Craig. So it'll be a real boost. If your kick-out press results in a score, you'll always feel really good about it. Back towards Darragh Craig. Craig with the left-footed shot. The crowd looks at it. The umpire nods his head. That's gone between the posts. That's a fantastic strike. Really good strike. And suddenly, for all Strokestown's good start, Boyle lead by 4-2.
That's what happens when you have three players, three or four forwards like that. That'll be an incredible shot there by Craig. Strokestown are bunching out here again.
Again, Strokestown bunch out, and this time they find a little bit of isolation. They find a pocket of space out on the left-hand side. Work that ball forward, but still Boyle have the sweeper back. In this occasion, Enda Smith is there. He's in front of Dearman McGann. So Strokestown hoist that one up long, looking for Colin Compton. Colin Compton wins the mark, probably a little bit too far out to go for a score. He's looking up, he's looking at his options here. The simple ball is to chip back to his brother Cathal. Cathal squared up here by Evan McGrath now. Evan McGrath still more or less playing as nearly as a third midfielder as opposed to really as an orthodox centre forward. Ball worked across here towards Malooly. Will he put the turbo on again and decide to go for another run? He's got Cathal Brogan outside him. Instead goes for the hand pass forward in towards Keith Murphy. Takes a good hit, but takes it really, really well. Stays standing. Ball worked out here now, chipped up towards Cathal Brogan, needs to keep his footing, did well to do so. It looked like one that you could slip on a wet surface. In now towards Kieran Regan with the hand pass inside towards Murphy goes off the outside of the boot. What a finish,
what a game so far, Kevin. Really really enjoyable game, but what a score too from Keith Murphy. Especially he did well to take that hit from Dylan East, so he'd be delighted with that.
Well, that was it, perfectly good shoulder to shoulder hit from Dylan East, exactly as you train. But great balance from Murphy there to be able to stay standing and to be able to work that ball into the chance. So now Boyle trying to work the ball forward into the half-forward line. We have yet another Strokestown turnover here. Well won in their own half-back line, and the ball is dinked across towards Paddy Brogan. Paddy Brogan, ball inside towards Malooly. Malooly definitely quite happy to play in a more advanced role here. In now towards McGann. Oh, that hand pass a little bit slick. Malooly can't handle it, gets it back at the second attempt. Lavin now, Cathal Lavin works the ball in towards Colin Compton. Colin Compton again, Boyle have loads of men back. Only Shane McGinley on the edge of the square. And Shane McGinley isn't really a big high ball target, though it has to be said, Daniel Casey marking him, not the biggest man either. So
we spoke a lot in the pre-game about Boyle's forwards. Well, one of their best forwards there, scoring forwards, Donny Smith, made a tackle in their own 45. So that shows they're not afraid to go back to field either.
Well, that's it. Donny Smith seems to have spent more time in the middle third of the field than the top third so far. He came forward to get that opening score, but other than that, really has been like that, putting in the tackles, putting in the work around the middle. As Evan McGrath here looks to carry the ball forward, no pass, instead decides I'm going to step up the pace of it, try and run at Cathal Compton. Doesn't manage to get by. Tadhg McKenna now. Tadhg McKenna also doesn't like what he sees in front of him. David Neary is effectively operating as the sweeper on the Boyle side. Sean Purcell now sprays that ball wide. Sean Purcell, of course, one of those really annoying people who's gifted at absolutely everything. Took up golf during lockdown. What did he go and do this summer? Won the Boyle Golf Club Captain's Prize. Played golf for many, many years, never won anything like it, and promptly had to give it up at a handicap of 13. But sure, look, if you're a former League of Ireland soccer player, Roscommon inter-county footballer, let's just face it, this man is good no matter what he turns his hand to. Enda Smith now dinks that ball backwards. Boyle again looking at plenty of defenders there in front of them. So it's patient stuff here from Cian Smith's side. There'll be no hurry on them. Ball worked across, back to the centre spot. Conor Flanagan coming forward now. Conor Flanagan gets the ball into Rock Hanmore. Hanmore will be patient. Worked out here now towards Donny Smith. Donny Smith looks for the low ball. Oh, just a little bit too far ahead of Dara Craig. It was patient stuff, but ultimately it worked out for Strokestown. They didn't give them a clear opening. Yeah. And in the absence of a precision pass, nothing happened.
That was the first proper phase of kind of prolonged play, passing around the defensive D that we had in the game. And Strokestown would be happy to see that one out there.
Absolutely. So a little bit of a pause here now. Oliver Kelly speaking to one of the Strokestown players, speaking to Sean Maloley.
Colin Compton looks like too.
Colin Compton as well. So just a little bit of a settling warning. Nothing that'll have to be entered in paperwork at the end of the game or anything like that. Colm Neary has broken into a little bit of space here. Instead goes short towards Maloley, but managed to recover.
Good kick out by Niall Curley there. It was a risky kick out, but it was a good, well-executed kick out.
But it had to be placed exactly where it needed to go. Niall Curley, of course, came back to the Strokestown team. Came back 2 years ago. He'd been working in Birmingham. He was forced to step up into action this year. Long-standing goalkeeper John McHugh out with injury this year, hasn't got to play a part in it. John McHugh, the only survivor on the Strokestown panel from the team that won the county championship, of course, 20 years ago. He's the one player who has a chance to add a second county medal here this afternoon. Must be a heart-crushing blow like that. You've been 20 years soldiering with the club. Now, look, he has his county medal, so in that sense, he's happy enough. But, you know, and then injury, you miss out on the year when you finally get there. I can't imagine the heartbreak for a long-standing club stalwart like that.
Yeah, without a doubt, John is a great Strokestown man. I see him down there at the clipboard and giving out water. So if Strokestown get over the line today, he'll have his fingerprints on the victory and he'll be well entitled to a minute too.
Well, I have to say, he was extremely helpful to me in the lead up to this. Like, I always try and sound like I'm knowledgeable in this, but at the end of the day, you're only as helpful as the research you manage to do. And what he provided me with regard to background knowledge in Strokestown was absolutely fantastic. You know, like, we have information ranging from their underage exploits to, he told me, Cathal Lavin can be found at a lot of agricultural shows with the family prized sheep. That's level of coverage you will not get on the Sunday game, folks. I can guarantee you that. While we have an injury stoppage here, I'd like to take a minute just to say thank you to the sponsors of this stream. These are the Leyden Brothers of London, owners of the WB Yeats N4 pub and the Owl Shillelagh, two fantastic pubs in the North London area. Really good spots. I've no doubt they have this broadcast on in front of all their viewers here this afternoon. Fantastic supporters of all things Roscommon GA. So if you're in a position, if you're in London and in a position to support either of those two establishments, we strongly recommend you drop by. You'll be supporting somebody who supports Roscommon GA, and more's the point, they're fantastic locations and you'll enjoy yourself while you're there. We're looking at another Boyle substitution here.
Colin Goldrick
waiting to come on.
Can't make out exactly who's down. Is it Keane McKeown possibly?
It looks like it could be Keane McKeown indeed. I don't see McKeown standing up there.
This would be a massive, massive blow to Boyle.
It would surely. Colin Goldrick, like, McKeown the attack, and sure enough, yeah, the sign goes up for McKeown. McKeown sustained a serious injury here in the final group game against Clon. He was carried off the field that day. It was a huge relief to Boyle when he was willing to come back into the team after that. Since then, in the two knockout games, contributed 1-6 with the dominant, with man of the match in the game against yourselves, 4 points again against St. Bridget's. So just the same as Kevin Finn being out for Strokestown, this is a game changer on the Boyle side.
Yeah, it is, yeah. And it, unfortunately, it doesn't look good at the moment. So we've seen well wishes to Keane, and hopefully he recovers as soon as possible.
So a huge change here on the Boyle side. Colin Goldrick now is going to come in. Does it change the way Boyle play the game? Because McKeown, obviously, is a man who would like to take on his defender. It's not, I've often said, Roscommon football, I find it remarkable. You're fantastic at breeding. Catch and kick inside forwards. Guys who like to win the ball and just get a yard to swing a leg and put the ball over the bar. Fellas who like to look you in the eye and run at you and take you on is not really the Roscommon thing so much. Keane McKeown is the exception to that.
Yeah, 100%. And he offers something, as you just said there, Kevin, so much different that he takes his men on more often than not. And just seeing De Smith here walking down to his brother Keane, I'd say he'd be getting some tactical advice here now, because they'll have to change something. At the moment, I suppose the way it looks is that Dara Craig plays closest to goal, and Donny is kind of the playmaker looking for Dara Craig. But McKeown is always lurking around that area too, and if he gets up to steam, he's just like Jeremy McGann, he's very, very hard to stop. So It'll be interesting to see what changes Boyle make here and where Colin Goldrick plays.
I mean, the obvious answer would be you decide to take Donny Smith and you say, look, we've had Donny operating around the middle third, but you're taking a ready-made county standard inside forward and you're putting him back into an inside forward role. That strikes me as the obvious thing to do. But the other thing is, all their training, all their preparation would have been based around Donny operating that role in the middle third.
Yeah, I do think, though, that Donny suits Boyle playing out the field because he's that link man. He gives the ball into Derek Craig. So when Derek Craig moves, he knows that Donny will give it more often than not. And it looks like Sean Maloney's gone over to Donny now, too, at the minute, with David Neary picking up Colin Goldrick.
That's the other side as well. We talked about already that Sean Maloney has been hugely influential for Strokestown carrying the ball forward. So if you force Maloney to maybe have to concentrate more on his defensive duties, or is that maybe, are you overcomplicating your own game in order to negate the opposition in that instance?
It works both ways, I suppose. So possibly Sean marking Donny means that he mightn't veer forward as often as he has been doing the last few minutes. But at the same time, Donny doesn't want to be tracking Sean going forward. So it kind of works both ways, I suppose. It depends on the players on the ball. If Strokes don't have the ball, does Sean trust the man to make that run and hope that there's no turnover? Because as we've seen before, Strokestown turnovers can result in Boyle scores. So it'll just be interesting to see how this pans out now.
Absolutely. Lengthy injury stoppage. And as you say, we send our best wishes to Cian McKeown here, who's down for significant treatment. I didn't see the nature of the injury, but absolutely, it's a game changer. But most of all, you don't want anyone sustaining a serious injury. And certainly not somebody who's has such a bright future for both Boyle GA and Roscommon GA, you'd have to imagine. Also, there's the fact now, too, like, we've had great momentum in this game. It's been high tempo. It's been hard hitting. 4 points to 3. We're now looking at nearly three and a half, four minutes of a stoppage at this stage. You know, that's not easy either. Do the muscles tighten up? What do you do?
100%, yeah. And I think that the opening period of this game here was very, very frantic until we had that period of Boyle play around the Strokestown defensive arc. So it'll be interesting to see how the game kind of changes after this moment in time. But I'm just still looking at Keane McKeown down here now, and I suppose my heart goes out to him because it looks like a serious injury, and we just really, really hope that it's something he recovers from as quick as possible.
He's being strapped to the stretcher here as we talk, so you'd have to imagine it looks like an injury where they obviously need to keep him steady and keep him still.
He's a tough cookie. He'll come through it.
There's no doubt about that, but as I said, but at the same time, it's psychologically it's a blow as well, because the one thing with Strokestown losing Kevin Finn is that the players will have mentally adjusted to it. They'll have realised, okay, well, we have to operate. He's a key man for us, but we just have to make do. Next man up. You know, it's different when it happens in game.
Without a doubt, yeah. And I suppose it's always kind of something I've noticed that when a player sustains a serious injury for your own team or even the opposition, it kind of just takes that level of, I suppose, maybe aggression out of you, because you see someone who's been seriously hurt. And we're just, Keane is being carried up here now at the minute, but it's heartbreak for Boyle really, and Keane too.
But it's that as well, because I mean, there's always the human side to it. You'll have that nagging doubt in the back of your mind, worrying about a friend of yours who is just being carried off. Like, I mean, people, you know, people aren't robots at the end of the day. Like, these guys are playing with their friends, they're playing with their family, they're playing with their cousins, whoever it is. You know, Keane, so on that regard, obviously Boyle, it'd be hard not to think about that. But one way or another, we're back underway as Boyle retain possession here. Tadhg McKenna now worked out here towards Enda Smith. Short foot pass out towards Dylan East. Dylan East, again, floated hand pass. Plenty of Strokestown guys back at the moment. Ball being taken into the tackle by Killian Cox. An illegal tackle, says Oliver Kelly. And we're going to have a free for Boyle. But difficult to engineer something from a free in a position like this, because there's not a lot of space in front of you, and at the same time, out of range for scoring.
Enda's looking to go short here. He gives it to Killian Cox.
Quite happy to just recycle the ball and see what they can engineer. Enda Smith just works that ball backwards towards Tadhg McKenna. McKenna now across and into Evan McGrath in the middle of the field. McGrath looks up, sees his options, doesn't see an awful lot. A little bit of a dink and run from Dara Craig in behind, or sorry, from Rock Hanmore actually. Rock Hanmore drifted to the edge of the square, so maybe there would be an opportunity to hang in a high ball as Craig now comes in. Craig comes onto his left foot. Is it turning enough? It is turning enough. What a strike! What a fantastic strike from Dara Craig.
He's capable of that. I've seen him before, and that's two fantastic scores. And I suppose the pressure now comes on him, comes on into Smith a bit more, comes on like Evan McGrath after Keane's loss.
And now we look at another temporary substitution here, and it looks like it's Sean Maloney going off this time. So we'll have to see who's coming in. It looks like Dylan Owens coming into the Strokestown side there. So we've had a lot of enforced substitutions here in this game so far. Ball broken down here now, long kick out. Boyle have done well enough on the Strokestown long kick out. When they have gone long, they've been able to pick up the breaks. Killian Cox was the one who was in the right place to win that one. Enda Smith now, trademark run forward. Tackle comes in from Keith Murphy. And between Keith Murphy and Paddy Brogan, they win the turnover again. Really well done. As Dylan Owens comes into the team here to replace Sean Maloney. So
Paddy Brogan is hurt here too, it looks like.
So both managers and both physios absolutely earning their corn here, because we've had a lot of disruption on both sides. It's a pity, because even the roar that greeted that Dara Craig point was muted. You could tell the energy has been sucked out of things a little bit.
Yeah, this is really unfortunate too. I see David Neary attending to Paddy Brogan there, and I know Johnny Smith was calling for the physio straight away, so players themselves know.
Yeah. That's it. They've been through, you've been knocking around, you've been playing adult football for 10 years and more. You know yourself when somebody is hurt and when they're and when they're maybe not so much in a bad way.
Yeah, definitely takes the sting out of the game at the moment. What do we know? We're now into 26 minutes. I wonder how many injury time we'll have.
Well, that's it. Like when Cian McKeown went down first, it was just over 18 minutes gone, and it feels like we've really only had the one passage of play since then. I was going to say, I didn't see an awful lot wrong with Sean Maloney when he came off, and I'll say there's a fair amount of blood on that bandage as he before he even comes back on at all.
I couldn't see any blood from where I was here now either, but Ollie might have spotted it. But Paddy Brogan looks like it could be a shoulder, possibly.
People of my vintage will remember the famous picture of, I think it was Terry Butcher, World Cup 1986. Why are you nodding your head?
That was before my time, but
that
I did hear
it. That was a long way before your time. That was... You're going well back. You're going well back before your time. But, you know... Now, I have to say, at the same time, the same Terry Butcher, of course, wouldn't have been a popular figure once he signed for Rangers, of course. But we won't go down that line of discussion. I was very impressed with Roscommon GAA's bravery, playing some rebel songs here before the start of that, inviting trouble on themselves. But maybe they possibly won't get as much opprobrium as the Irish women's soccer team, and hopefully not for doing so. As we resume play here, David Neary chips that ball back towards Niall Curley. Niall Curley decides he's going to carry that ball out. No obvious pass. And we're just going to knock the ball around here in the Strokestown defensive area. Boyle have everyone covered here. There's no one in an awful lot of space. Cahill Compton trying to make a run, but no easy options here. So Boyle can get a bit of pressure.
Pushing up much higher here now. They're trying to look for that turnover inside the Strokestown half.
So Niall Curley takes possession again. And it's the classic kind of leave the keeper alone. I had a manager always used to tell me about that. If a keeper carries the ball out, let him out. He's a goalkeeper. He's in there because he can't play football. Now, I won't say that. That's the junior level that I was operating at. Probably a little bit different. As Dearman McGann loses possession in the tackle. Psychologically, that's huge from a Boyle point of view. Dearman McGann is the talisman there, and if you turn him over, that's a big thing.
Yeah, a great turnover from Boyle, but it was actually initially a great run by Colin Leary to free up space to kick pass, and his brother David kicked it to him. So Strokestown would be very disappointed with that, because they actually had a chance to attack, say, in even numbers against the Boyle defence, so Dearman will be disappointed with that.
100%, and I see there we've another change there on the Strokestown team confirmed. So Paddy Brogan, gone off the field as we expected from that injury, and Mikey Kavanagh comes in to replace him. Mikey Kavanagh has come off the bench in each of the last three games. As another shot coming in here from Dara Craig, didn't really get the meat behind that one, didn't get his laces behind it, and that's just a second stoppage.
9 minutes additional time at the end of the first half. At least 9 minutes additional time.
So that'll tell you everything about how the game has gone so far. 9 minutes of additional time has been added here, and I'd say that's probably exactly right. So ball broken down on the Strokestown side. Cahill Compton gets his hands on it. Compton feeds that ball out here towards Colm Neary. Colm Neary well able to run, but decides he's looking for the pass here. That's
great
an
ball.
Excellent ball into Shane McGinley. McGinley now looks up, decides he didn't want the shot, instead goes for the hand pass outside to Cahill Lavin. Lavin with the right foot. Does he like it? He does like it. Really good finish there from Cahill Lavin.
What a score by Strokeson there. Colin Meary, very, very, very good pass. And Shane McGinley didn't take the easy option to shoot with left foot. He actually gave the ball to Lavin, who had an easier shot. And what a great score.
It was a lovely run as well from Shane McGinley. He took up a great angle. You know, he managed to create the space for himself on the edge of the D. And when you can get that nice bounce pass in front of you, that's what every corner forward dreams of. Strokeson has turned this over. Cathal Brogan came back, knocked the ball towards Colin Neary. Another long ball forward from Lavin now, looking for McGinley. McGinley got out in front of Conor Flanagan, but Conor Flanagan does really well. Oh, I'll tell you, he is a... Conor Flanagan, he was described to me as an excellent former piano and chess player. Well, I'll tell you, excellent work with the hands there to work that dispossession. Whether it was the piano that trained him that, or whether that's Cian Smith's training, who knows? But either way, Boyle still with possession. Donny Smith still playing quite deep there now. And I see he was the one that gave that ball sideways. So Boyle have opted against. They have gone with Colin Goldrick as the inside forward.
And Inda is hugging the wing here a lot. You see him cutting in at the moment now.
So. Enda Smith with that. Oh, what a ball into Dara Craig. Ivan Needle pass. Oh, Craig, low shot. Pulled across the goals. What an opportunity. But my word, you have to say that's a fantastic pass from Enda Smith there.
I think Dara will be disappointed with that, but we've been treated to some fantastic passes here at the moment. And just what a pass from Enda here.
Had the vision, shaped the ball around two Strokeson defenders, got it into Dara Craig, onto the right foot, and just pulled across the goals. Look, it's his weaker foot, but he still would have backed himself to score in that situation, I'd say.
Another turnover by Donny there.
Another turnover. So it's not the role we would have expected him to play, but it's definitely a valuable one here. So we're 2 minutes into 9 minutes of stoppage time. Donny chips that ball across into the middle, into Rock Hanmore. Rock Hanmore, well stood up by the Strokeson defence. No foul there from David Butler. David Butler, of course, rugby player as well, so he'll definitely be strong in the tackle. Ball out here towards Enda Smith, and now Dylan East takes possession. Dylan East with a low left footed pass again, looking for Dara Craig gets out, but it's well broken down on the Strokeson side. They just can't stop it going out over the sideline.
It's a great battle there between Timmy Gibbons and Dara Craig. I thought Strokeson might give him some more help with the sweeper, but it looks like they're going to leave him one-on-one inside.
Timmy Gibbons, of course, another player, was his only in his second year of senior adult football, I should say. Done really, really well this year. Carved out a corner forward or corner back spot for himself at the start of the year, and has been an ever present in this team. And to me, it summed up the trust that John Rogers had in him. That right from the first day, he was given a serious marking job against St. Bridget's. As we come in here, another chance for Boyle. Donny Smith drifts forward, and Donny Smith puts that one between the posts. Vital score for Boyle there, kind of settled them after they've missed a couple of chances.
Yeah, Strokeson will be disappointed with that. Now, it was a player on the real fire left-hand side. I'm not sure if the camera picked it up, but David Neary chose to go for a more difficult pass and just be a little bit disappointed with the execution there. But big squeeze here again from Boyle. Strokeson on either hands on possession big time.
So yeah, 10 Boyle players were up at midfield or higher, and they managed to get the turnover. They didn't win the primary possession, but they have secured the turnover. Enda Smith drives forward. Dearman McGann tackling him. That's a great ball from Enda, looking for Dara Craig again. Craig, plenty of pressure on him. David Neary is squaring him up. Ball worked back out here. First touch for Colin Goldrick, but it's not a good one. And Strokeson have won a turnover. There's a bit of space here now for Keith Murphy. Keith Murphy, Colin Compton makes the near run. Shane McGinley is the man deep. High ball in there, looking for McGinley. McGinley's fighting for it, but it's broken, and Sean Purcell is in the perfect position.
It very really well is defended by Boyle there.
It is a defender's ball, though.
Yeah,
really.
It is, yeah.
So Rock Hanmore now is the man taking possession. Right-hand side crosses into midfield, looking for Donny Smith. Donny's got a little bit of separation on Timmy Gibbons, but the ball isn't accurate. Timmy Gibbons decides safety first. Bit of pressure coming on. Chips the ball out for 45.
I think it's very important here for Strokeson now. We only have a couple of minutes left in this half, not to concede two or three more points and go in kind of almost out of touch of Boyle, because it looks like Boyle could tap on a few more scores here before the end of the half, and Strokeson need to really kind of lock down this defence now.
Yeah, well, I think it's fair to say it's not that it's been excessively defensive football, but at the same time, look, we're currently 6-4. We might have another point or two before half time. We're not looking at a high-scoring game here.
No, I think it's the intensity of the tackling, as we've seen there from Donny Smith and the likes of Sean Maloney, Colin Neary and Timmy Gibbons. Like, the intensity of tackling is making it very hard for these forwards to score.
Well, that's it. These are guys, look, I mean, it'll be a much quicker job to count all the players that haven't played inter-county football at some level or other, as opposed to count the players on the field that have. So these guys have all played, the vast majority of them have played at a high level, as Strokestown work this ball out here, and Kieran Regan chips that ball forward. Open country in front of Sean Mullooly, has 40 yards of space to run into. Mullooly drives forward, takes it to the opposition 45 metre line, and he's still going. Hand pass wide here now. Keith Murphy has one score already, but he wasn't in the right position. Colin Compton back in towards McGann. McGann looks for the little give and go. Instead, Lavin goes back inside towards Colin Compton. Good scoring chance for Compton. Oh, and that's a disappointing one. You would expect Colin to score that all day.
Strokestown worked that opportunity so well there again. I think they need to get Jermaine McGann a little more into the game if they can.
But it was McGann's excellent running there, because the fact that he went for the give and go, it forced the Boyle defence to commit themselves. It opened up the space for Colin Compton. And really, you can't ask for a better chance than that. Boyle coming back at them now, trying to carry this ball out of defence.
What a tackle
from Colm Neary. Colm Neary, I think it's a very safe bet to say that if new Roscommon under 20 manager Noel Dunning is here, and I assume he is, he'll be penciling Colm Neary onto his team sheet for next year, absolutely.
Initially before that too, was actually a great kick out by Rob Kearney. He found Evan McGrath on the run, straight into his chest. Niall Curley's coming up here for the kick.
So we have Niall Curley coming up. We haven't had a long range free of this nature so far for Strokestown.
If he gets this, I think Strokestown will be kind of somewhat count their blessings that they're only a point down with a few minutes to go.
They had the better start. They were on a lot of possession at the start. Just a two-step run-up, but how about that for a strike?
John McHugh will be proud of that one.
There you go. That's all down to McHugh's goalkeeping coaching. That's all part of it. But look, it's part of the game anymore now. I mean, long range freeze is pretty much part of the goalkeeping package.
Neary again. Kearney is looking for Evan McGrath.
Neary wins it. Ball in here. First touch for Mikey Kavanagh. Fields it in towards Dearman McGann. McGann on the run. Clips that ball. Oh. Strokestown have had a couple of chances here between that one for McGann and that one for Compton. Really well done by Neary, and a good ball from Mikey Kavanagh again. They're good chances.
It came from the Boyle kick out. I think, say, one of Rob Kearney's strengths is the ability to find someone on the run. But at the same time, when the Boyle players are moving so ferociously for those kick outs, when they don't go right, they're opened up. And that stage there, you saw McGann could have and probably should have put Strokestown level. What was actually interesting there was Enda Smith was actually on the Boyle 21-yard line when the kick out was taken. And here he is in the ball again.
Came back there to his own 45 to win that one. Oh, a little bit of a stumble there from Evan McGrath. Lets the ball between his legs. Enda Smith won't thank him for that. Strokestown have the turnover. Colin Compton in possession now. Colin Compton shrugs off Smith's tackle. He has Mikey Cavan inside him. But what a hand in from Conor Flanagan. Really well done by the Boyle fullback. And even though Strokestown retain possession, the danger is gone more or less. Back towards Colin Compton now. Compton out towards Neary here. Boyle have plenty of players back. Everyone other than, it's looking like two Boyle players are inside their own 45 metre line. Ball chipped forward now. There's a little bit of space here for Cathal Brogan. Cathal Brogan breaks inside the tackle. No foul given. Dearman McGann wins it. That was a free hand on the back there from Cathal Feely. I have to say, my own call, I think Oliver Kelly got both of those decisions right. No foul the first time and foul the second time.
Yeah, I think correct decision, but I think you see Sean Purser down there. He was incredibly angry with the way the Boyle players allowed Ollie Cage to make that decision, because Jerv McGann was surrounded by three or four Boyle defenders. So this should put Strokestown level.
So McGann here now, he only has one score to his name so far, point from a free.
It's just interesting to note here too, sorry, until Jerman takes his free. Again, you see Inda is currently playing the number 6 position, it looks like, in the kick-out. So one of Boyle's best fielders, he's just slowly making his way out to midfield now, but looks like they have Rock Hanmore and Evan McGrath around the middle, and Inda is playing somewhat almost as a centre back at the minute.
I'm surprised actually they haven't targeted Rock Hanmore with more kickouts, as there's the half time whistle here, and this is absolutely finely poised here. 6 points all. It's really impossible to separate these teams.
It's a great game of football, Kevin. I think the last 5 minutes, Strokestown delighted. But Boyle missed a few small opportunities to really push out the lead. Going in a level at half time, it's very, very hard to call. I did a draw before the game, so I'm sticking with it.
wonderful piece of fence sitting, but I suppose we can excuse it because any call that Conor would make here, it might turn into it might be pinned on the dressing room next time either strikes down or Boyle playing Michael Glavy's. He's nodding his head here, so he's certainly not going to make any problems for himself next time. He's not going to make any problems for himself when the 2023 club championship rolls around. So we're going to take a break here. Again, I'd like to say thank you to our sponsors, Lane Brothers of London, for bringing this coverage to you. I hope you're enjoying this game. It's been really, really fascinating stuff so far. It's been physical, it's been intense. There's been nothing bigger than a 2-point lead at any stage in the game, and it is absolutely finely poised. We're going to be back with you in 10 minutes for the second half of Boyle versus Strokestown. Don't go away. Welcome back here to Dr. Hyde Park. Boyle are back out on the field. We're still waiting on Strokestown to come out from the dressing room. Just there on your screen in front of you, you will see again the QR code. You can scan that and you'll be able to download the full match programme from this afternoon. It's well worth taking in. It's 80 pages of excellent content. Keep you fully informed about everything with regard to these two teams. So you can scan that QR code if you're casting this game to your TV. Alternatively, visit bit.ly/RossGAFinal22. That's bit.ly/RossGAFinal22. And you'll be able to download that program for all your player profiles, background information, everything to do with this particular game. 6 points all at halftime, Conor. Look, I have to say, you sat on the fence calling a draw at the start. You know, but the fence is kind of the place to be at the moment. It's really impossible to call either side as having the advantage.
It looks like it, but I suppose thinking all week, it was very, very hard to separate these teams. And that's why I went for the draw, really and truly. But I think it's who takes the game now with the scruff of the neck, really. And I think Strokestown won't be overly happy with maybe the amount of involvement they've got out of Jeremy McGann. When he's got on the ball, he's been very influential, but they want him on the ball quite more. And I suppose similar enough for Boyle, like Inda again is going out here to left half back from the throw-in, and I just think they need to get him a little bit more active, a little bit more in the game. Strokestown are definitely making Boyle wait here. Anyway, they're not rushing out.
No, it's the I know it was always the tactic on wet and miserable days. I'll always retain a little bit of bitterness from 2010 on Ireland qualifier between Offaly and Down in O'Connor Park. And Down did that. They basically locked themselves in the O'Connor Park dressing room. I was part of the Offaly management team then. Now, we were more fools to not go back in the pitch. But they got a goal within 2 minutes of the second half and beat us by 2 points. They went all the way to the All-Ireland final that year. I'm not going to say Offaly would have made it to the All-Ireland final, but okay, what the hell. I will say it. Offaly would have made it to the All-Ireland final. And I retain my bitterness. But look, this is all part of it. When it's like that, you probably won't mind because you can move around a little bit and, you know, you won't mind being out on the pitch there, stretch the bones out a little bit. I won't imagine it'll discommode Boyle in any sense.
No, it depends which way you look at it. Boyle could be more than confident going into the second half, or I suppose into the scoring goal. Alternatively, Strokestown could be trying to, I suppose, slightly put Boyle off their game, but Strokestown are definitely all here. We come now. David Neary running out.
Strokestown back in. There's a question for you. What makes a scoring goal? Every ground has one, and I've never quite... I can understand it in some places, but not necessarily here. Why would they say... And I understand people do call the graveyard end the scoring goal. What makes it easier?
I think generally, say, on the new pitches, as you said, there's no hills on these new pitches, modern pitches, but in the Hyde, the wind tends to blow into the graveyard, and it just always seems like it's quite easier to score into the graveyard end, I suppose. Maybe that plays into your psyche as moment when you're lining up. But I think Boyle will definitely fancy themselves into the graveyard into here. So,
yeah, the only one I always remember being a big issue was you would know at Gracefield, which is an Offaly club on the Laois border. It's two pitches that are end to end. So essentially, you have one set of goals nearly backing onto another, and they have two ball stop for each goals, both of which are held up with white posts as well. So when you turn around and you look into one end, you very quickly see eight white posts looking at you, which is an absolute nightmare, to say the least of it. You know, unless, of course, you're like me and you're stone useless and it gives you an excuse. It's kind of a leveller between me and the good forwards. But, you know, but other than that, that's one where I kind of understood. No such issue here. No, that's why I'm saying you wouldn't see any reason why there would be... there would be an issue one way or another as we get ready to start the second half here. Another thing as well too, of course, is halftime managers might start thinking about substitutions, but they've kind of used a lot of their substitutions already, so they've already gone onto their bench due to those injuries, which kind of changes things as well.
Very good point, Kevin, yeah.
So ball underway here, and Cathal Compton knocks that ball down towards David Butler, tries to get it across towards Cathal Brogan, but he fumbles possession and Boyle have a turnover straight away. Killian Cox gets that across to Cathal Feely. Now Colin Goldrick hasn't really had a chance to settle into it. That's a good ball from Goldrick, fired down towards Dara Craig. Craig still being squared up by his man there, tries to get the ball inside. Timmy Gibbons forced the error. Ball towards Goldrick, that one's dropped short, and Niall Curley gathers it easily, feeds that out towards Kieran Regan, and now chance for Cathal Compton to carry the ball clear. I see Cathal Lavin has created a bit of space here, but Killian Cox gets back to cover off the danger. Strokestown working the ball down the right flank here.
Switch on here if you look up.
Switch on here, loads of space for Cathal Brogan, but instead Dearman McGann decides to take it on himself. He now has men either shoulder, decides to put the burners on. Oh, drag down from Rock Hanmore.
We could be looking at here, yeah.
We could be looking at a black card here, I'd say.
I think Rock could be a little bit unfortunate there, because I think he meant to genuinely tackle Jeremy McGann, but he slightly kind of almost fell into him and it looked like he tripped him with his foot, but could be interesting to see what Ollie does here.
Yellow card.
More often now as a player, you start to realise that Ollie probably won't give a black card for a similar instance, so it's a fair call as long as he sticks with that kind of a decision.
So Niall Curley, he's hit one over the bar in the first half. Chance to strike another one here. Again, just a couple of steps of a run up. Possibly hooked left, as hooked left. And that's Strokestown's fourth wide of this game. It's very impressive to be able to get that distance from such a short run up. You see some guys and they can definitely get 60, 70 yards on the ball, but they might run up to it. Really well done on his part to be able to get it that distance with just a couple of steps behind. Ball into Rock Hanmore here, and Rock Hanmore fouled at midfield.
Tyke McKenna's gone,
and Donny Smith puts it right into his chest. Oh, McKenna loses his footing at the wrong time, and Colm Neary wins that ball. I'll tell you, Colm Neary, he has to be in the man of the match shake-up in his performance so far.
At this moment, yeah, without a doubt, but I think Tyke McKenna's a bit unlucky there. Just the underfoot conditions are very, very slippery. We saw it in the earlier under 20 game, but he's a bit unfortunate. But again, Colm Neary is right at the heart of any turnover that Strokestown are creating.
So, quick interchange of passes between Lavin and David Neary. Ball out here now towards Cathal Brogan. Cathal Brogan back towards Neary again. There we see Sean Purcell still taking up that position just in front of the last Strokestown man forward, who is Shane McGinley. Dearman McGann still operating in the middle third as well. Inside here towards David Butler. David Butler carries it forward. Simple pass towards Cathal Compton, looking to find a probe, a gap here. David Neary with the low ball gets past Purcell in towards Shane McGinley. Was McGinley dragged down? He was. To me, that was all about the accuracy of the pass. Just past Purcell there, gave McGinley a chance to fight that ball.
Inch perfect pass from David Neary there. Sean Purcell was nearly at full stretch and just couldn't get to it. But again, great movement from McGinley and the Boyle backs. They're very, very tight, but on this occasion I think he was just a little bit too tight to Shane McGinley, and I think it's a fair free in for Strokestown. And this is Strokestown to take the lead.
So Strokestown's chance to take the lead. Dearman McGann has 2 points so far to his name, both from frees. Stands over this one with his right foot. The trademark swing of the ball right to left. And puts that ball straight between
wide
the
ball, holes. Wide ball.
Wide ball. Whoa.
Wide ball.
I've made the mistake of judging by his own reaction. That's a dreadful miss. And I made the mistake of looking at his own reaction. And he looked calm. He didn't have the distraught look of somebody who had missed a 20-metre free. So a huge reprieve for Boyle there.
It can happen. These things can happen. But I suppose pressure is a funny, funny thing too.
So this is the thing. So a lot, we'll learn a lot the next time Dearman McGann gets a scoring chance. Will he be able to put that behind him? That's a big part of being a forward, to be able to put the last miss behind you and still execute your technique next time. Cathal Feely floats that in. Colm Neary gets the subtle touch on the ball, touches it away. Niall Curley picks that up. It's similar to the first half in the sense, start of the first half, Strokestown with plenty of possession but haven't put it on the board.
I think there's a big battle here between the sweepers too, between Sean Purcell's involvement and Colm Neary. And at the moment, probably Colm Neary is just edging it in terms of his influence on Boyle in their attack. bit of a risky pass there.
High ball across, but David Butler, probably the strongest man on that Strokestown team, he was quite happy to get put his body in there and win that ball quite comfortably. Worked out here now. Malooly takes possession, going back towards his own goal, and feeds it back towards David Neary. Boyle not pressing up too high here. Quite happy to let Strokestown pick their way around and recycle it over to the far side of the field. Mikey Cavan has made a bit of a run. Instead, they go for the long ball, partially blocked down. Kieran Regan gets it at the second attempt, hangs that one up. Colin Compton is underneath it. Compton fights for it. Compton wins it. Bounce the ball. Can he get the shot away? Sean Purcell puts in the tackle, and Sean Purcell forces the error. Probably needed to shoot first time, I'd say.
Colin's very, very unlucky there. He did so well to win that ball. And he was trying to play Shane McGinley, I think. But
so big win. It was a big win of possession, but Boyle did well. That's two reprieves on the Boyle side. Dylan East now. Can Boyle come down and strike the far end? Dylan East takes possession here. Ball back inside towards Killian Cox. Donny Smith now going backwards.
Into playing very, very deep.
Coming on it from deep position. So yeah, the two Smith brothers playing much deeper roles. You know, it's like, I never would have expected Rock Hanmore to be playing farther forward than Enda Smith, like, out of the two midfielders.
Slightly strange, I suppose, because I think the first score of the game could have been Enda's point on his left foot, and that was what he's able to do. I think David Butler's picking him up here now, but Boyle seem a bit more kind of settled in possession. They're happy to kind of work the scoring opportunity.
But that's the thing, like, I mean, the last couple of games, Enda, whether it's the injury or whatever, hasn't been a huge contributor on the attacking side. Here he has been, like, we had that glorious pass for Darragh Craig's goal chance. You know, the score as Boyle break in here. It's Cathal Feely fighting for possession. Brave work there from Cathal Compton. Got down, smothered it, but that hand pass is gathered and by Luke Glennon. Ball back inside for Boyle. Looking for Colin Goldrick. Doesn't quite find him. Again, Boyle have turned it over a second time. Another Boyle possession. Shot off balance, being pulled to the ground. And here's going to be a Boyle chance.
The defending is ferocious here now from both teams, especially the Strokestown defence. The defending is ferocious.
It's hard to know who got the reprieve there, in the sense that Boyle had the chances and Strokestown managed to execute the block, so they didn't get the goal opportunity when Cathal Feely went in. On the other hand, Strokestown had two chances to clear their lines there and didn't do so.
Very interesting too. Just before Strokestown came out at half time, I saw Colin McGoldrick practicing his frees in the absence of Keane McKeown. So it looks like he has a free kick here now to give Boyle the lead, and it'll be, again, just like Jim McGann's previous three, the pressure will be on him here because he's just coming off the bench. So
huge one for Colin Goldrick as we wait. Cathal Feely is there getting treatment now. It doesn't look severe. It looks like it's just a case of, you know, just making sure everything's hunky-dory before he starts up again. Get a little bit of water on board, though he is hopping a little bit. So
it looks like he went kind of soccer style, kicked the ball at the net. I think one of the Strokestown defenders got in the way, so
it was a brave diving block from Cathal Compton, and it was perfectly legal block, we should stress. Got down low, smothered the opportunity. So opportunity here for Colin Goldrick to put his name on the scoreboard for the first time. It's a high kick, he's looking at it, it's close, and eventually they go for the flags.
The most relieved man in the hide is Colin Goldrick.
He wasn't confident there. He did that sort of tilt of the neck as if he could kind of guide the ball in after.
It's over though. Still
it's counts. Over. It counts on the scoreboard. 7-6, and Boyle are back in front.
So I'm surprised Boyle haven't pushed up. Well, they are here now. So Dylan East is pushing up to Cathal Brogan.
Score from the free is usually the opportunity when you can push up.
And Strokestown have persisted to go with this kind of bunching tactic from the kickouts.
David Neary pulling out. It looks like David Butler is the free man down the middle, and sure enough, that's
great
right
kick
on top of Butler.
Great kick
right on top of his hands. Perfectly accurate delivery from Niall Curley, who's been really, really good here this afternoon. Quick ball out. Chance again for Colin Neary to carry the ball forward. McGinley makes the run. He's out in front. Really well done by McGinley. The tackle comes in from Daniel Casey. Forces the spill. Dermot McGann takes possession again. Powerful run. Breaks through two tacklers. Colin Compton now out towards Colin Neary. Pity they couldn't keep going. Shane McGinley probably just outside of range here. In towards Colin Compton. There's a man in acres of space. Oh, he just undercooked the pass. But it was a goal opportunity if he got that through to Keith Murphy. Just under hit pass. Those are the little moments that could decide county finals.
Good work from Enda Smith though at the same time. He saw the danger, he read it, but a bit more on that pass and I think Keith Murphy would have been in for a goal chance. This game is getting a bit nervy now.
It absolutely is. The tension is creeping in. This is where it shows that these 30 men that are on the field at the moment, not one of them has played in a county senior final before. Now look, several of them have played in Connacht finals and big occasions like that, so it's not like the big day is unknown to them. But at the same time, this is a unique occasion. Pressure of the parish looking on. As Boyle worked this ball forward down the left wing. A little bit of space opening up here now in the corner. Back out towards Goldrick. He's just got that one from a free. What a block, Cathal Compton. But Goldrick gets it at the second attempt. He's hooked that one wide of the target.
What a block from Cathal Compton there.
Really big block. Like Compton, the same as Enda Smith, doing more defensive work here than attacking work.
The Scotland GA would like to especially thank Dr. John Kelly from Boyle.
Cahill's tackling has always been that way. Once he gets near you, it's very, very hard to get away from him.
Today's county final. And we wish both players a
speedy recovery. A note of thanks coming out there for Dr. John Kelly, who was the man who looked after both Cian McKeown and Paddy Brogan following their serious injuries. So again, all we can say is best wishes to both men. We hope they both have a speedy recovery and that things aren't as severe as they looked. And that you never know, maybe they might even be back to play a part later in the championship, though that probably looks unlikely, I would say. But here's hoping. But anyway, long ball forward here from Boyle. Broken down, looking to break it down towards Colin Goldrick, but it's not won. Strokestown sweep up the pieces and now they come out of defence. It's really, really tense at the moment. 7-6. We're 11 minutes into the second half and we've just had 1 point on the scoreboard. It's tense stuff. Colin Compton now takes possession. This is probably more like what we might have expected from two sides playing their first county final pretty much ever as far as these players are concerned. Of course, Strokestown last here in 2002. Boyle last here in 1927. Suddenly a load of space opened up if Colin Compton could get that back. Get the ball across to Cathal Lavin, didn't get it through, and instead they're smothered and we have yet another turnover. I know they talk at inter-county level about percentages, the number of possessions you should turn into shots, the number of shots you should turn into scores. I would say that in terms of possession into shots, the strike rate is low here this afternoon.
Yeah, I think so. And it's hard to know, it's probably a little bit of nerve on the attacking team's part. Behalf, but at the same time, the level of intensity in the tackle here is really, really, really high. And I think it just all feeds into the narrative of the game. These two teams, first final in a long, long time for both clubs. And I just think both players want to win so much that they're willing to do anything to stop the opposition scoring. I think whoever has the most composure here is going to go a long way to winning the game.
So, Enda Smith making a break forward, and that's a high tackle from Cathal Compton.
Big tackle.
On Donny Smith. That's definitely a high challenge. It's going to be a free on the 45-metre line and I would anticipate it's going to be a card for Cathal Compton as well.
Cathal could be in a small bit of bother here now. I don't think there was much intent in it or malicious intent, but he did catch Donny high. It would actually ruin the spectacle if he was to get a red card, but I'm not sure what Ollie's going to do here, to be honest.
My gut feeling is yellow is the most likely outcome and definitely it's a comparatively short
yellow,
conversation,
fair.
It is a yellow card.
I think Donny will feel that though. I don't think he's staying down for any effect.
No,
I think he felt that one big time.
Well, my conversation with Donny interviewing for the Roscommon Herald in the lead up to this final, he talked about how when they got the penalty against St. Bridget's, they were under a bit of pressure and he was like, I was taking that no matter what. He wanted that pressure occasion. So I'm sure, you know, we're in a game here. It looks like it's going to come down to some pressure moment close to the end. I'd say Donny would fancy himself, he'd want to be the man to take on that pressure.
Yeah. It'll be interesting now if he takes this free. He's after getting quite a heavy hit there.
Well, Cathal Feely has taken the 245s and this is effectively a free from the same location.
Donny has it though.
Donny has it in his hands. Another substitution there on the Boyle side. Eden Kearns coming in. So another Abbey Community College student. He comes into the team. He came in briefly, of course, for a few minutes as the blood sub for Sean Purcell early in the game. And Rock Hanmore makes way, veteran of this Boyle side. So Donny with the left-footed strike. It's curling, it's curling, it's over the bar. This man has, he stepped up in a big way in that county semi-final against St. Bridget's, and he's stepping up again for his team here. That's his third point of this afternoon, which is particularly impressive when you consider where he's played. He's played most of his game in the middle third.
Definitely, and with Rockhammer going off to now, it looks like Inda will go back to a more traditional midfield role. But Colin Meary again here.
So brilliant catch, Colin Meary wins that ball, driving forward again, feeds it in towards Mikey Kavanagh, and there's a pull on Dearman McGann close to goal, and it's going to be a free on the 20 metre, on the 13 metre line even. Dearman McGann there, I think he was being picked up by Luke Glennon, but I'm not exactly sure, so I won't malign Glennon, it could have been somebody else. But either way, off the ball foul, and a chance for Dearman McGann to maybe exorcise the demons of that last miss, tap this one over the bar, and maybe put Strokestown back on the front foot, because 2 points, not a big lead, but in this game with scores coming so intermittently, it's significant enough. McGann chips that between the posts, 8-7.
You can see here Strokestown's press, they have four across the full forward line.
Four across the full forward line, three at half forward, three at midfield. And you would say even...
Boyle have actually put five players across essentially their own full back line here.
But the deep kick is on here. It's Evan McGrath who's come out to try and win it. Cathal Compton goes up against him. Cathal Compton does enough to spoil it, and it breaks through for Cathal Brogan, who comes back. Brogan, that kick didn't look controlled, but it eventually worked its way through. Sean Malooly carries forward now. Malooly driving in, Lavin comes out and wins it inside towards Colin Compton. Colin Compton, chance to level the game. Shoots off the right boot, looks like he likes it, he does like it.
What a score from Colin Compton. Started by Sean Malooly there, Sean Malooly's run initially.
He had a great opportunity in the first half, he pushed it wide to the target. That was more like the outcome you would expect from Colin Compton. Veteran player in this Boyle side, and he puts it between the posts, and we have a level game all over again. Kearney looking out at this side, really good hands there from Evan McGrath, and tries to chip that ball, doesn't do a good job. Keith Murphy is able to intercept, but it's lucky from a Boyle point of view, breaks back on their side. Sean Purcell carries it forward out here now towards Cathal Feely. Feely, quick hand pass inside towards Killian Cox, being squared up by Cathal Lavin. Lavin with a little bit of a pull there. And again, I'd say after Donny Smith nailed the last one, he'll fancy his chances here too, I'd say.
Straight away, Donny will signal him to Killian Cox to lead the ball down. There's only one place he wants to put this.
Conversation with Aaron Claher. Aaron just looked at his watch, so presumably Donny was asking about time. Long way to go yet. Aaron also probably pointing out the spot.
Two former DCU men.
Yeah. I was looking there, Donny wanted Aaron's verdict. He wasn't looking towards Ollie Kelly. That's a bit like the 10-year-old child that knows which question to ask of mammy and which one to ask of daddy. And he's pushed that one wide of the target. Didn't expect that. He thought Aaron was going to give him a more favourable spot than Ollie was. So, hence, that's why he was looking towards the sideline. Either way, I don't think I'm being unfair to Donny there to say that one was well off target. So, Niall Curley with the kick out again. Again, Strokestown breaks side to side. And a good, well-placed kick out from Curley finds David Neary. But Strokestown under
press
a bit of pressure here.
Curley.
Couldn't quite get there in time. There's a spare Strokestown man over on the far side. And that's Timmy Gibbons. So Timmy Gibbons carries forward. Oh, a little bit of a fumble might give Dara Craig a chance to get a little bit of pressure on. It's been a tough game for Craig in the sense that he had those two chances in the first half, kicked two good points, but hasn't really had scoring chances since then.
No, he hasn't got into the game in the second half.
Though I was at the Roscommon Senior Hurling final yesterday, and we saw the patience that a good corner forward needs to show. Brendan Mulry hadn't really been in the game at all, hadn't got the type of long ball deliveries that... he thrives off. Didn't feature in the game until the last 10 minutes when he suddenly scored two goals. So if a corner forward can do that, that's a decent contribution any day. Strokestown now looking to take possession, looking to actually take the lead here in what would be for the first time in the game. David Butler carries that into pressure. Sloppy hand pass. Evan McGrath gets the turnover. Evan McGrath draws the foul. Again, hesitant move there, David Butler. The hand pass wasn't really on, I'd say.
I just think the nerves are really coming to the fore here now. What have we got left? 10 minutes and a little bit more. and the underfoot conditions along with a bit of tension, I think it's just lended itself to a lot of turnovers. I don't think many more points would be needed to win this game from either team.
No, we're already at a stage here where you'd say any team gets to 11, that would certainly be enough, barring a goal. Because we've only had, when you think of it, we've only had 2 points each now in 10 minutes of, or in 20 minutes of play in this half, which is very, very low scoring.
Sean Rogers is signalling to, looks like, Jeremy McGann to move out to the wing.
Yeah, well, I see Colin Compton is still down. He's the one being treated now at the moment. He was the one trying to win that lose, trying to turn that ball over when Evan McGrath won it, and didn't quite succeed in doing so. And of course, you've had Mark Dowd on the Strokestown sideline as well. Very astute guy. He spent a lot of time with Roscommon senior teams in the recent years. So plenty of experience on both sidelines here. Cian Smith, of course, it's Boyle's first county final for all these players. It's not Cian Smith's first. Guided Coolera Strand Hill to the Sligo senior final 3 years ago. That one didn't work out for him. Cathal Feely. Sometimes I think in instances like that, there's a sense of the referee, well, look, maybe it was a close call, but you had all the time in the world, so you had no excuse.
I think Cathal unfortunately gave Ollie the decision. He gave him the chance to make the call.
Mm.
And it's just one of those things again. He'll be consistent, I'm sure he will be, so I don't think Cathal can have too many complaints.
Well, absolutely. I'd say there was an element of you had all the time in the world to take that. Mikey Kavanagh wins that ball well. Fed back inside here. Worked out now, David Neary in possession. Neary and Murphy both charging forward. Back in towards Murphy. Oh, he was swallowed up there. Didn't really want that pass. You know, it would have been a low percentage effort from Neary, but at the same time, maybe you have to start going for those low percentage efforts at some stage. As that ball, it's kind of a little bit of a raffle delivery, and Sean Maloney gets in to win it well. Powerful from the Strokestown fullback. But I say Strokestown fullback, you know, I'm looking here at this stage. Maloney's at midfield, Neary's at midfield, Murphy's pushed forward, Kieran Regan is pushed forward. There's really no... The shape has gone out of this game in a big way.
Very hard to know where players are actually playing.
Shape has definitely been lost. Colin Neary again, lovely burst of acceleration. Gets past Colin Boldrick, hand pass into McGann. McGinley now, back to Neary. He wants the return pass, but McGinley had been knocked to the ground. Neary now gets it away. Can Strokestown get a shot away out of this? McGinley, bit of a pull. No foul, says the referee. Says Tyke McKenna's tackle was legal. Ball worked out here now towards the right-hand side. Sean Purcell, the only man within 30 yards of the goal. They're not actually having any target man in there whatsoever. And we're back out now towards Maloney.
Very patient from Strokestown here.
Very cagey stuff on both sides, both in the sense that Strokestown working the ball from side to side, and Boyle not trying to press with too many players either. You look even at the way Enda went up, and David Neary there wasn't looking to force the turnover. Just stay goal side. Back in Kyle Compton to Colin Compton. The brothers exchanging passes. Good ball inside now. Is this a chance? Oh, heavy traffic again. Just couldn't get facing the goal. Dermot McGann goes to ground. Five Boyle players around him.
Serious tackle from Boyle there.
They just couldn't get facing the goal whatsoever.
There was a big collision there between Dermot McGann too, and I'm not sure who's down on the Boyle side.
It's hard to... It looks like
Tyke McKenna
is down. I was going to say McKenna. So Boyle on the break here now, but Cathal Feely goes backwards.
It almost looks like neither team wants to lose this game as opposed to which team wants to win it.
Well, the other side of that is that it's been confirmed we will have extra time here this afternoon. Now, we won't have a penalty shootout, so we will have extra time. So if it's level after 60 minutes, we'll have 20 more. I'm not sure if the nervous systems and indeed the aortic systems of the Strokestown and Boyle supporters will be able for 20 minutes of this, because this is tense. I'm feeling it, and I have no vested interest here whatsoever. Ball in towards Donie Smith.
Another great tackle by Sean Maloney.
Well, good hit from Sean Maloney. Wins that ball.
Donie is hurt after two.
Yeah. I'll tell you, running the ball into that kind of red scoring area, it's no place for the faint-hearted in there, because on either side you're getting swallowed
Without
up by
doubt,
bodies.
Yeah. Great point.
Mikey Kavanagh now. He has Cathal Brogan outside him. But Kavanagh decides not to give that pass and instead comes backwards towards Lavin. There's really very few options. Actually, a good few Strokestown players on the other side of the field trying to keep width on the game. I noticed that as a trend this year, particularly with Derry and Armagh, were the two sides where they nearly have three or four guys hugging the touchline, the opposite touchline, sort of a tactical innovation. So remains to be seen. Derry definitely had a successful year. Armagh probably middling so. Long ball down here now. Shane McGinley wins it well. Can he get a chance to get a shot off? Hasn't got on the scoreboard yet. Forced that one there, but an excellent diving block from Daniel Casey. Full length, got himself on McGinley's boot and took the sting out of the shot. I don't know if it's going to go for goal, but Casey was taking no chances. Enda Smith carries it out now. Works that ball out towards the left wing. Dylan East carries it forward. East gets inside the strokes on 45 metre line. Enda Smith again breaks the tackle. Chance for Smith now. Floats it up towards East, but gave the defender a chance. And sharp stuff there. Timmy Gibbons did really well. He got a sniff of an opportunity to get a hand on the ball and got in. There's been so many near misses like that. You look at that hand pass. You look at the pass from Colin Compton that Enda Smith intercepted at the other end. It just feels like we've had that, these near miss moments.
Yeah, no doubt. I see Derek Craig was slightly playing a bit further away from goal during that last play. If I was Keith Smith and Boyle now, I'd be looking to take Derek Craig on the ball a little bit away from the D area where there's less bodies and ask him to take on those shots like he did in the first half, because it looks like neither team is going to score a simple score from around the D with the defensive work that's going in from both sides today.
Absolutely. I see Michael Fallon is the next man to come into the team there now. So Michael Fallon comes into the Strokestown team. We'll see in a second who's making way. It looks like it could be Kieran Regan, or Keith Murphy actually is the man who's making way here. Murphy has put in a very, very tough shift, got an excellent score in the first half. That Strokestown give that ball away. Glorious chance now for Donny Smith. Will he pop this over the bar with his left? It's a great chance, it's a great score. Crucial turnover ball.
I think David Butler went down to win a low, low kick pass and just bounced out of his chest, and Derek Craig pounced in and got it and then gave it to Tony. Boyle will take that all day long.
Vital score here. So Michael Fallon making his first appearance all year for Strokestown. Veteran, of course, traditionally has been lining out centre-back and full-back. Another giveaway, another chance here. Enda Smith is in now. Chance to come back onto his right foot. He's put it up. He's put it high. He's put it wide.
I think that sums up the last few minutes in this game. Inda, 9 times out of 10, would pop that over with his eyes closed. But the pressure really, really is on here.
I have to say, definitely, the errors have crept into it. Neither side really playing to their potential at the moment. They're making mistakes. Again, we have another substitute, this time on the Boyle side. This time it's number 22, Jack Moran, coming into the side. Another promising young player.
Connor Flanagan.
So Jack Moran comes in for Connor Flanagan. I have to say, interesting change now, because Conor Flanagan for me has had a very, very good game here.
I thought Conor Flanagan was excellent today. It looks like that Killian Cox has gone back to what seems to be like a full back position, cornerback position, and Dylan East too has gone back, Merrick and Cahill Lavin. So interesting call there from Keane Smith, but he must have a rationale behind it, getting a more attacking player on the field.
Absolutely. Well, there's no doubt. Look, Killian Cox is experienced at playing in the full back line, so there's no issue there. My surprise just stems from the fact that I didn't think Ronan Flanagan did an awful lot wrong. And generally speaking, guys wearing 2, 3 and 4 don't get taken off unless there's a problem. But either way, Dermot McGann here wins this ball. A little bit of pressure on Strokestown now. They have 2 minutes plus whatever is going to be added on. The time has just bled away from us here. It just feels like the game has never really exploded into life in this half. Ball chipped forward towards Timmy Gibbons. Pressure on Strokestown now. They have to come up with a score here. Sean Maloney carries it forward. We've gone into the 45 metre line, but there's a huge number of Boyle bodies back. Donny Smith, the only Boyle player outside his own 45 metre line at the moment. Ball worked across here towards Colm Neary. They need to create a scoring chance out of this somehow. Cathal Brogan now. We're just going side to side here. No real player running off the shoulder. No one injecting a little bit of pace into it. No one even making runs to try and ask questions or shift the Boyle back position.
I do think what Strokes are doing here, though, in actually bringing the ball a bit further away from the goal to almost suck Boyle out is a good option. And they need to run here now at pace. But there's just so many Boyle bodies back there. It's hard to see how they're going to get a chance to get a decent scoring opportunity.
The only thing is it only works in terms of sucking them out. I take your point, but Boyle aren't coming out.
No. You know, and they've actually gone more defensive now. They've brought every player behind the ball at the moment.
Even Donny has come back as well. So David Neary now takes the ball in. Cathal Compton in possession. Colin Compton, we know he's well able to shoot. Colin goes with the left.
What a score!
What a crucial score for Colin Compton. Calm as you like, off his left foot.
Colin is one of those players whose left foot is equally as good as his right foot. And you saw that there.
That was a vital, vital score. And we've another stoppage here now.
I wish I backed the draw.
I'll tell you, it was always a strongly possible outcome.
Strokes are right pressing here.
Strokes down, chance of a turnover. Cathal Compton is in, wins this ball. Evan McGrath pushing the back.
4 minutes additional time at the end of this
second half. There's going to be 4 minutes added on here. We've already had 30 seconds of that 4 minutes. But we had the mistake at the far end that led to Tony Smith's point. And the free has been brought in.
Oh, that is a killer.
Oh, that is huge.
Well, that was incredible work there from Cathal Compton. It was one of the few occasions in this half where actually Strokestown pushed up every single player. They did not leave a sweeper back for the kick out, and it paid off massively there. And Jeremy McGann has a big, big free here.
What I was really impressed with Cathal Compton as well was that even as he was going down, he got his foot under the ball to make sure he didn't lift it illegally, and that meant that the foul, it drew the foul. So Dearman McGann, chance to chip this ball over the bar, and watch it, it has gone over the bar. The shout from the Strokestown crowd will tell you yesterday was a huge day for the black and amber of Four Roads in Ath League. Today could be a big day for the black and amber of Strokestown here in Dr. Hyde Park. Big kick out. David Butler gets up. He wins it. Colm Neary. Neary completely taken out off the ball, but Strokestown retain possession. Cathal Compton throws that one up. Has he kept it on target? No, he's pushed it wide.
Strokestown aren't dropping off here. They're pushing up. Then Cathal Brogan here is the free man. He's making his way up. Oh, he's staying now, actually.
Yeah. But I'd be interested to see the sanction here because Dylan East completely took out Colm Neary after he gave that pass. So by rule, it could be a black card here. Yellow again. It could have been a third man tackle, but
he's
either way.
He's being consistent.
Number 25, Tony Allen, will replace number 13, Shane McGinley.
So Shane McGinley, teenage corner forward. He's had a I'm actually been quite impressed with McGinley today, despite the fact that he hasn't scored. He's been a good lead. He's led the line really well. Tony Lavelle comes in to replace him. What a huge catch there by Evan McGrath. So dinks that ball into the middle. Now the pressure is on Boyle. They've got approximately 80 seconds to try and find an equaliser. Ball worked forward here. Donny Smith, it's the right man anyway. Donny Smith hangs it up with his left boot. Oh, he's pulled it across the goal. It was a wonderful, wonderful effort. Boyle now going to the pinch. Mark O'Connor comes into the Boyle side. Can't see who's being replaced here, but Mark O'Connor is coming in. It's going to be Cathal Feely who steps out.
Boyle have to push up here. They cannot give Strokestown an easy kick out. Dylan East is looking around for a man, he can't find anyone.
Number 20, Mark O'Connor has replaced number 12.
So the long kick out from Curley takes no chances. Dearman McGann goes for it. Breaking ball. It falls on the Boyle side, but a Strokestown man has it. Tony Lavin comes in. Tony Lavin, oh, he tried to get the hand pass. Last chance for Boyle, surely. 20 seconds of the 4 minutes still to be played. Sean Purcell has possession now. Into Donny Smith. Will he get another opportunity? Donny Smith. They're going side to side. There's players wrestling on the ground here. Possible pull. It's a Boyle free, but it's 55 metres out from goal. Colin Compton deciding for himself. As Donny Smith, he hoists it up with his left foot.
Oh,
it's in. It's over the bar. What a strike. We talked about Donny Smith. He wanted the pressure kick. Well, my God, did he deliver under pressure there. Colin Compton took the decision. He just completely pulled Smith down to the ground. He took the decision that I'm going to gamble. I'm not going to let them work it up. Surely he's going to blow it here. No, Ollie Kelly is playing on. We're going to have one more play. It is 10 points all here. Will there be another chance? Strokestown have possession. Sean Mullooly driving forward. Mullooly now, right-hand side. Will they get to engineer another scoring chance? You get the sense, don't come back too far. The referee could blow the final whistle. Put your boot on it. Low ball to McGann. Will he get the shot away? It's Tony Lavin. Tony Lavin.
Over the bar.
Left foot over the bar. My word. What an unbelievable finish here. We thought it was all over when Tony Smith split the posts. But Tony Lavin, he wasn't. They wouldn't have, when they brought him on, they never would have expected him to be the winner. And it's all over. It's all over. 20 years later, 20 years of agony for Strokestown has come to an end here this afternoon in an unbelievable finish. Donny Smith showed nerves of steel to put that free over the bar from 55 metres out. We thought that was going to be it. The 4 minutes of stoppage time was up. But Oliver Kelly said, no, it's at least 4 minutes. I'm going to allow one more play. And as he had done all afternoon, Sean Mullooly drove forward, carried that ball in, into Dermot McGann. The layoff out to Tony Lavin. He wouldn't have expected when he came on to be the man in that position. But sure enough, he was there. He trusted his left boot, even though he was on the left-hand side, and he split the posts.
Bro, you're a fucking
bastard. I'm
breathless
because of that.
Come on,
yes! Yes!
Well done! Come on, you're a fucking legend,
Lily.
Come on,
Yes! Come on!
Outstanding! Oh my God!
Yes, boy!
Congratulations,
welcome.
Where's Jordy? Where's Jordy? Where's Jordy? I haven't seen Jordy at all.
It's
okay,
isn't
it? It's okay,
isn't it? Sorry. Yes!
Oh, God!
Cheers, bud.
Jackie, brilliant.
Thank you.
remember, John.
Oh, he's a sick.
Well done,
Sorry, lads, can I get through?
Thanks to his linesmen Aaron and Mick and everyone of our match officials on here, and I call on Ollie to come forward here and accept the presentation from our fixtures committee secretary Brian Mullen. Finally, a special thanks to our groundsman Pete and everyone here involved at Hyde Park. It has to be said the pitch looked fantastic today considering the rain we had overnight, so thanks to Pete and all the ground staff. Thanks a million for the use of your facilities all year. It saved us travelling, it saved us on costs, so thanks a million to them. To the local community, anyone who took part in the sponsor player drive the last couple of weeks, it's greatly appreciated by the players. It costs money, unfortunately, to train now, so thanks a million. And a special mention to those who gave donations on their own back and sponsored different things for us over the last 2 years. So thank you, 2 weeks, so thanks for that. To our two main sponsors, Scott Hunter at the Sportsman's Inn, and Pat Rogan at Rogan's Tractors, even though I think it's Pat that's running the show there now. thanks a million. They've been with us since the start of the year, so it's greatly appreciated, lads, and thankfully we've something to give you back for your money. to the local primary school and secondary school in town, just the support we've got off you for the last 2 weeks, seeing everybody get excited around the town. The different competitions that were being run. Thanks a million for all your support. It was greatly appreciated. All of our underage coaches, and especially those involved with the setup of our academy over the past couple of years. It's been massive. We've always kind of talked about having success at underage, and that's what this week has been built on. So, all of our underage coaches this year, but especially mention to anyone who's been involved over the past 25 years coaching anyone off this team. The work that goes into the background is unbelievable, and this wouldn't be possible without all of you, so thank you. Just on that, I want to give a special mention to our under 13 team who won the county final yesterday. To our co-executive members, Alan Nolan, Brendan Kelly, John Cullinan, Donald Handley, Laura Cullinan, Michelle Nolan, Trish O'Byrne, Leo Shields, Sharon Towie, Eugenie Handley, Martin McDermott, and to our club presidents, Tommy Flanagan, Tony Flaherty, and Pete Shield. This has been a long time coming, and to anyone else who's been involved over the past 25 years on finance committees, executive committees, thank you. Sorry, Murph is the player rep on the club executive, I forgot to mention him. Thanks, Murph. A special mention to Anita Moore and Josie McGann, our club treasurers. It hasn't been easy this year, I'd say, getting money for everything we want, but they managed to do it, so thank you. To Joanne McGinley, our club secretary, who's been there for half a century now, I think. And to Paul Machine, our club chairman. The work ethic the two of them have is unbelievable, and it really is appreciated by all the players, so thank you. The pitch committee, the stewards, the shop workers, the lava sellers, and to Alicia Regan, who does our Twitter feed for the games, and we haven't lost since Alicia started doing the Twitter, so thank you. To anybody who helped with decorating the town over the past 2 weeks, it's been unbelievable, especially coming back to Dublin at the weekend. So thank you. Nearly done, I promise. To all our parents, the families, wives, girlfriends, children, thank you for putting up with us for the past, whatever it is, 10, 15 years. Especially those who make food for us after training. It really is appreciated. We might show it all the time, but on behalf of the players and the management, I want to say thank you. This win didn't just start this year, it started last year. I want to thank Declan Kavanagh and Anthony Gibbons for their work with the Junior B team last year. We won the Junior B Championship at the end of the year, so thank you to them two boys. Ronan McPhillips and Martin McDermott managed our Junior Bs this year. It was the first time in a long time we fielded three teams. And to Pierce McGinley and John Cullinan, who managed our Junior A's. The fact we were able to field three teams, it made it a lot easier for us with numbers of training to work on things we wanted to do. So thank you. To our backroom team, James Clancy, Justin Campbell, to John Neary and Patrick McHugh, who videoed games for us. John McHugh, my own brother Brian, who done video analysis for us, to Paul Kenny, to Kenny Kenny Gadd and tonight to over our physios and our SNC. Thank you, lads, for all your work. Thank you. Our selectors, Jerry Nolan and Mark Dowd. They came in with Raji last year. Jerry came from out of town. Mark is a so-so man, diehard, true and true. He added a lot to us, boys, different perspective than we never had before. The quality of the coaching was unbelievable, and we never wanted for anything. So thank you. To Paul Goose Daly. From under 20, junior and senior. He does a lot of work picking up bibs, picking up goals, filling water bottles. Little jobs that go unnoticed, but it really does make it a lot easier for us. So thank you, Gooch. To our manager, our leader, John Rogers. Back in 16 and 17. Fortunately, he didn't go our way that time, but we were delighted when he came back involved last year. His commitment to the club and to our team is unbelievable. If you've seen some of the things he comes out with, there's lads scratching their heads where he comes up with some of it at times, but no one can doubt his commitment, his passion for Strokestown, and it rubbed off on everyone else this year. So to Raji, this is for you. The last few years, we've been talking about potential, potential, potential. Today, we finally delivered on it. It's unbelievable feeling to be up here representing ye along with Chairman. It's something we've all wanted to do for a long time. And I'm sure when we get back to town, we're going to celebrate this in style.
Congrats, my man.
Thank Cheers, you. Thanks very much.
Well done, well done.
Thank you.
Well done. Cheers. Cheers. Thank you. Thanks, Will.
Well done very much.
I'm joined now by the heroes of the hour, joint captains for Strokestown, David Neary and Dearman McGann. Lads, my voice is hoarse after commentating on that game. What was that like to play in?
It's hard to put into words what it was like to play in. Like, it was just nip and tuck the whole way. Like, we go ahead, they go ahead. Like, we couldn't push them off there near the end. I thought we had them when we went to point up, and then Tony kicked an outrageous score there. But we dug into the end, and lucky Tony came off the bench and kicked one off the left.
Doesn't happen too often.
Yeah.
I was just thinking that. I was saying it didn't look like the most natural left-footed kick in the world, but says you, it doesn't matter. It went over the black spot. Yeah. That's all that counted.
Yeah.
Even that moment, first of all, tell me, Tony Smith puts that ball over the bar from the free, 55 metres out. You know, you're thinking, are you just thinking, okay, it's extra time now, or?
I was thinking
yeah,
replay.
I thought, I think it was going to a replay. I don't think there was extra time today.
Well, there was.
So, that was all in my head. Luckily, Niall got a good kick out off, and we were able to get down the field again, and thankfully, Tony came up trumps. It was one that we actually worked well. We'd probably turned over a few handy ones before that, but luckily, we were able to go down and finish it.
It was an extremely physical game throughout. Look, a county final is never going to be anything else. But like, there was a couple of times I saw the likes of yourself trying to carry the ball in, and it felt like the lads were just descending on you. You know, it was... Yeah. That must have been exactly what you expected. But second of all, is it hard to keep patience when you're not scoring as freely as you'd like?
We just have to keep the heads. We practiced it in training. We knew what Boyle were going to bring to the table. They were going to filter everybody back. And then in the end, like, we bought a few handy frees there. I missed a handy free as well there, but we bought a few handy frees, and then when we broke the line there at the end, when they didn't have as much men back, and we got the winning score out of it that way.
Yeah. Look, you get to stand on the podium and collect the cup in front of, let's be honest, everyone who's had anything to do with Strokestown for the last 20 years and longer is here today. I mean, even the emotion of that must be huge right now.
Yeah, it's like I said it there, like, this isn't just about this year. Like, this has been built with the last 25 years whenever the older members of our team started playing underage. So just to see kind of the older lads from the club the mothers, the grannies, and just how happy it can make them and things. It's unbelievable. Like, and just looking out there when we were getting the cup, to see everybody with a smile on their face and what it has done for the town. Look, it's, you can't really put it into words.
Did you feel it was coming? Like, I know in the week leading in, you'll always say, look, you know it's going to be tight, you know it's going to be tough, but lads involved would always tell you kind of a day or two before the game, you might get a feeling one way or another that I'm a little bit worried, or no, I think this is going to go our way. Was there any instinct like that in your blood Friday or Saturday?
I was confident. I've, like, we had our last meet-up Friday, like, and there was just a good vibe. Like, you can kind of tell when boys are together. Like, there was just a good vibe there. Everyone was positive. Like, we didn't really do much. Free takers kicked a few frees Friday, but I thought we were in a good place anyway.
We were in a good place going into it. Like, we were building from the Oran game. We weren't great in the group. We were probably, our best game was probably against Pearce's the last game, and then we built on that. We got better and better every game. And that's a bit like, we might have been lucky to get out of the group, but nothing is won in a group game. Groups, like, you just, it's all about getting out of it and building on that then.
Big setback as well. I only learned today that Kevin wasn't going to be fit to play today, so that took a little bit of adjustment as well.
Yeah, like, Kevin was massive for us, especially since the Oran game and the Roscommon Gaels game. I think against Roscommon Gaels, I think he had something ridiculous, like, he had eight turnovers or something. Yeah. Like, the work rate he puts in on the half forward line, he mightn't get written about, but, like, it's unbelievable what he does for the team. So, like, we just kind of had to next man in, but for him personally, I was disgusted. Like, look, myself and Jeremy have played with Kevin since we were under 10, like, he's the same age as us. So, on a personal note for him, it was devastating. But, look, we just had to kind of put the work in for him and make sure he has a chance now to play again.
And one last thing, fair bit of family pride there at the end when you see Colm getting the man of the match. Yeah. Or is it just Ara Fekit, he's outshone me, he's taking the limelight?
No, I'm used to it now. He's look, he had an unbelievable game there. I think for Jeremy to have Shane, his nephew, in beside him as well, it added a little bit for us. So, look, fair play to the two boys. First year into the senior setup, out straight out minor. A bright future ahead of them. Colm had a great game there. He deserved his man the match award. So they just need to keep building on that now.
Thanks a million and congratulations, lads.
I don't think anyone can describe this win. It's to me, it's probably sweeter, maybe because it wasn't, no one seen it coming, and it came at the right time. We have a lot of bits and pieces that we need to sort out, and this has helped no end. And the winning on the 13 yesterday evening, that's where I'm looking at. Brilliant to get that as well as senior today. And tonight, it's not about all our problems, it's about celebrating this mighty, mighty win. And that's the way I'm looking at it. So, Patrick, go in there and get the real stars of the show and do your best with them.
I will do. Thanks. Coleman.
Thank you. And the black and amber! Well done, Joanne! I'm going to hand you over to the chairman of Soakstown Gay Club, Colman Sheehy, wherever you are.
To be honest with you, I'm stuck for words.
First time.
As I said to the lads in the dressing room, there's no need for words this evening. That's the word. David Neary, I think, covered everything above on the hide. I don't think he left anyone out. But, look, this has been a brilliant weekend. Yesterday we had under 13s, today we have the seniors. And I was fortunate enough 30 years ago to be involved. And we won it in 2002. And I think today, to me, is the best of the three. And that's from being involved in the ball. This is a great. We know we have sort of problems off the field, but on the field where it counts, between those lines, between the posts, it counted today. It was brilliant. And a huge thanks to John and his management team and everyone connected with it. He finished off the job that was started here with people come back to say John Rogers went to a county final in 1992 to see his neighbours playing. And that's where the seed started in 1992, to see Martin McDermott and Owen Donnan playing in the county final. So that's what you're hoping for the next 30 years, that someone will get the same benefit as John did from that day. And we're lucky. And I said it to the boys in the dressing room later, Mark Dowd and John, I was involved with them at underage, and the one thing I knew, anything to do to perfection. Nothing is left by chance. Everything is thought out and done. And when the fellas bought in, all these 40 lads, whatever's here, bought into it, that's the key. And once we got over, Orton, I felt that we had a chance of winning it. I felt comfortable in the semi-final and again today, and I think and I think a major thanks to John and his management team for what they've done for us today. That it gives the whole of strokes to my lift. So I'm just going to hand it over to John Rogers. And by the way, this is the first time I've done this to him. We won the failure in 1995, he was the captain. And that's where it started, and a proud man here.
All I have to say is, on the town!
I better start with these two beside me and my wife down there where she is. Right, it's 10 years Thursday since I was last faced with not as big a crowd now, but above in the Hudson Bay. So that day was was one of the best. I know. To see what I'm seeing here in front of me, I can't put into words. Like, I was asked after the game to sum it up, but you can't. As Coleman says there, in 92, I went down to El Finn to support Shiner here in front of me, and Owen, he would have been my two neighbours there, and just there under the big tree below in El Finn, I was beside Shiner's dad Noel, and the amount of giving out he was doing, that's where you sowed the seeds. And to see the under 13s win their game last night, like, I went up to Anthony and Damien afterwards, and I says to them, ye kept your side of the bargain, so I think we kept our side of the bargain there today. So And even earlier on in the day, the Miners were unlucky to lose their game, but that's what it's all about. Like it's great that these lads here up on stage, that they're actually showing all these young ones here what can be achieved with the work that goes in. And I've seen it with the academy that was ongoing this year, and it was set up last year, and you can see the fruits. Like, I don't think half the people here would be here tonight, only that they have their kids involved in playing GAA for the town. And look, that's what it's all about. Like, we're only passing through, but I hope that this has sown the seeds for the ones that are going to school, that they're not going off playing rugby or soccer or whatever, that they're picking up. I went down that road myself, but it was the 2002 team that was my first year back. I thought that day that, geez, this is great, there's going to be more, but unfortunately it doesn't work out that way. And these lads here beside me and behind me, you have to realise that these don't come too often, so cherish it and push on even further. Like hopefully this year isn't finished yet, and stranger things have happened, so but I'd say to each and every one of you that are here tonight, like, this means so much to us. There was nights now that we'd be coming out of training and we'd be saying, what the hell are we at here? And your head would be going doing somersaults because since the start of this year, we picked up Knox, and I think it was the first league game actually above Lurch and Paddy clashed heads. Kevin went down on his ankle, but still Lurch and Kevin were able to go skiing the following morning. But look, I mentioned two of them there. Kevin, obviously, he's been a big part of this group. Only for him, we wouldn't have been here today. I think me, Jerry, and Dowdy had a chat with Kev above in Shandona, is it, Kev? And he had been a naughty boy that weekend. But in fairness to the man, he says, I'll be right when I'm needed. And he was. Look, we got through the group by hook or by crook, but we were there. And that day, up in the heights, like, it's been a while now since Strokeson have put two wins back to back up there. But three now. But, like, to see Kevin come to training last Wednesday after, like, we were above in the hide last Sunday morning, he went down to A&E to get bad news, and to come back up, and, like, we were in the middle of the AVB, and
to see Kev come up, and I just knew by looking at him he was gone. But he, to a man that he is, he came to training Wednesday night and drove it on. I had to tell him go out and change the boot. That's it wasn't going to be common knowledge. But I think word got out. I think Fla had it above him. But look, he epitomises what I want from the team. He puts his shoulders to the wheel, just gets on. Like he's our main kind of tackling count man. He just goes after those numbers. And once you're getting tackles in, as Jerry explains to the lads, that when we have high tackle counts, that means we're in the game. So that's Kev. But to see Paddy, what he's done for Strokes down through the years. Like he put his shoulders to the wheel. He's probably his own worst enemy on the field at times. But he did mean that goal again. And you can flag him all you want, but he's the reason that we're here today as well. And to see you. Obviously, first of all, Keith McKeown went down injured, and no one wants to see good players go down. And he was a big loss to them, but equally Paddy was for us. And to see him having to come off, it would have broke us as a team before. But I think we've built a good squad all last year and this year, and that's been my motto from the first day. If you're good enough to train, you'll be good enough to play. And lads have put their shoulders to the wheel. And I mentioned it after the game that the lads who were on the bench that didn't get on, and the lads who weren't on the bench but were there, like they're the reason as well that we have this cup here in front of us. And I know some parents probably should be, they'll probably be thinking that their son should be playing, and probably rightly so. I'd be thinking the same, hopefully, when these grow up, that they should be playing. But at the end of the day, we can only put 15 out. 5 can come on, and unfortunately, it's a team game, and that's the reason why these lads are as bonded as they are. There's a good few cliques were in the group at the start, but we've done a few things, and you can see the camaraderie with the lads. Like there's going to be fair slagging over the next couple of days between them, but they're well able to take it, and they're well able to give it. So I just like to finally wrap up that the lads be glad to hear. Look, to ye, this is as much for ye as it is for us, and I'd hope for years to come that I'll be down there looking up at some of these here in front of me, whether it's the ladies or the men. Like we're all one, and that's the way every club should be. But I think this can light a fire in the whole town, because at the end of the day, the more volunteers we can get, the more your children will come out, and the more good days we'll have. Because it's been 20 years for me personally that I'm experiencing this. I didn't take on board the win in 2002, but by Christ, I'm going to enjoy this one. Right?
Okay, thanks very much, John. I'm going to hand you over to David for a few words here.
He won't talk. He done his talking on the field today. I just want to just thank every single person that's here. After the semi-final, kind of the emotions came out, and to see how much it meant to everyone in the town, it was incredible. Last weekend to have the teams from 92 and 02 back, it just kind of showed us like kind of the bigger picture that we were playing for. We've been talking all year about doing it for ourselves that people have been talking about our potential, but the last couple of weeks have really drove home what the kind of bigger picture is and who we were really doing this for. So I just want to say thanks to every single person that's here for your support over the last 2 weeks. Sean Mullooly has just arrived, if you want to get him up on stage.
Fashionably late as always.
I think Jerry Collins has just landed as well. So Jerry, up here. Jerry, get up. Sean is kitted out in his club gear as per usual. Raji has touched on everything there. Like, this has been a massive panel effort. Just again, thank you to the players. From the Junior Bs, the Junior As, the Under 20s, the Minors, the whole way down through the Minor Club. This is for everyone. I thanked everyone in the Hyde. I'm not going to go through everyone again. All I'm going to say is, Raji talked about his wedding 10 years ago. We had the Minor Trophy. We won the Under 21. There's a couple of weddings coming up in the team now, and we've got the big one for them.
Sorry, I won't hold you down this time. I want to say a special mention to the two men, obviously. I don't think Jerry has been mentioned in the paper the last two weeks.
Come on, Jerry!
A bit of background on this man, right? He's obviously going to be a converted Soakstown man now. But look, when I went looking for men to come in with me two years ago, these two were the top two I went after. And obviously Jerry has been there with Western Gaels before in 2013. Unfortunately, they didn't get over the line that day. And a good mate of mine, Mark, obviously we've soldiered through good days and bad days on and off the field, and the knowledge that the two lads have brought, I can't put it into words. Like, I'd probably get the headlines being the manager, but at the end of the day I'd sooner be coaching. As I think we've had a good balance between the three of us, and it would be remiss of me not to mention those two lads, because they have been an important thing of this team, and I think it's important that I acknowledge them. So just I'd pass it over to Jerry for that.
I don't have a whole lot to say. I suppose the lads will be glad for me not waking them up at 6, 7 o'clock with the same message for the last 10 or 11 days. But, you know, it's a great achievement for you, lads. I said it, I no doubt, I was away from all this. Like, I only live a couple of miles out the road, but I still wasn't around the town. I wasn't around the town where you'd see all the hype and the build-up to this. I was away, it was very relaxing. You know, I could control, you know, my own feelings and emotions going to this game. And I was 100% clued in, and I swear to God, there was no doubt in my mind that we were going to win this game. And the boys, to the letter of the law, from Curls right out to Tony coming on, you know, every one of them that's done everything to the letter of the law that was asked from the get-go. So look, just from my point of view, as adopting a crest, as I say, you know, thank you for taking me in the way you have, 100%. Some mates made for life here, and it's just a...
Okay, I think we have fairly all the lads covered. John is going to give us a song here that might suit the occasion. So, John.
Shiner.
just sprung it on us here. Is there any song, Canadian song or something else? So just came to my head. I know, I think in 92 and maybe others in the older generation they would have sang this song. It's not quite a Strokes Down song, but some of the lyrics apply to us. So I'll just sing I'll sing a couple of verses of it. And if anyone knows it, join in. Dad, I know you know it. In my memory, I will always see the town that I have loved so well, where our school played ball by the gas yard wall, and we laughed through the smoke and the smell. Going home in the rain, running up the dark lane, past the jail and down behind the fountain.
And the belly, all the town.
Those were happy days in so many, many ways, in the town I love so well. Let's skip to the last verse. The music's gone, but they carry on, for the spirit's been bruised, never broken. They will not forget, but their hearts are set on tomorrow and peace once again. For what's done is done, and what's won is won, and what's lost is lost, and it's gone forever. And we pray for a bright, brand new day. It's not.
Together, just show your appreciation to the 2022 County Champions, Strokes Down! Let's go and enjoy yourselves, lads! Well done!
I'll ask you questions and you answer them. Never mind the camera now. Jimmy Gibbons, cornerback today. It was Mark Keane, one of Boyle's so-called star players, Dara Craig. And hold on, Timmy, let me see where... Yeah, there he is, Dara Craig. Is in Timmy's pocket. Timmy, thoughts, reflections, how's it feel?
I don't know, it hasn't sunk in yet now, anyways, but I'm just kind of, I think the backs, one of the play animals that we kind of, how they come to work, they kind of stuck together as a team at the back. And I know the lads up front did what they could, like, but I know, I don't want to say it, like, I called you well, my man, as well, like, I'm happy with the performance too.
It's your first full proper year playing senior football. You were in last year and all that. You started with the Roscommon under-20s this year training and all that. It didn't quite go your way then and all that, but it's come around to a happy ending for the year. It's not over yet, but you got what your main prize probably was.
I have to go back to the senior lads. They backed me all the way, like, you know, I came back straight in, and they kind of gave me the confidence and they helped me along the way as well, like, and from my down from Pierce's, like, I kind of drove on against the Warren Gales and against Dale, like, so I like to thank the senior lads.
And how does it feel? It's a special one in the Gibbons household. You're joined by your twin brother Robbie, I don't know where he is now, and your elder brother Keane.
Caught them all, they know.
Can you tell us how's it for the Gibbons family this now?
Well, it's a great day for the Clunkham men, the mountain men as they want to call us. Delighted to be back involved with the team. Chipped away for a few weeks. Sunshine supporter. Back when it matters. But like Timmy saying there, the boys pushed on all throughout the year. Like, so proud of Timmy now. Stepped up. pocket's full there, Derek.
And we go back now to me. Rumour has it that you're looking to restart your drumming career now. Is
yeah. I took Brian from Patrick and the Castleby band today.
Right.
Culinary, man of the match. Your first in there, some of your football. This is easy, this practice.
Yeah. I wouldn't say it's easy, you know, but great feeling. Like, playing with all the lads, even lads that I pledged Shane, like, all the way up, it's unbelievable. It's some feeling, like, even last year in the under 20, like, a few lads, Kieran Regan, Timmy Gibbons, Robbie Gibbons, like, it's some feeling, like, to be fair.
So, your first year as a senior, looking at the team on the sidelines the last few years, what was your thoughts coming in your first year?
We were always close, like, to getting there, like, getting to a few semi-finals, a few quarter-finals. Like, they knew that we just needed, I know, it probably was a bit of belief, like, that we could get over the line, like, in the big games, because like, the potential was always there, like, as we always talked about, like, but, getting it over the line, it's class.
For the Neary family,
it's class, like, having the two of them there with me, like, especially, like, it's unfortunate for Brian this year, like, that he did the shoulder in August, but because he was pushing the two of us on, like, even as David said earlier on the week, like, he's the driving force for me and David there, like, he pushes us on to be the way we are, like, on the pitch, and he gives us motivation the whole time, like, and it's savage there playing with David today in a game like that. Just, it's some feeling, and mum and dad at home, they're always driving you on. Probably get a bit too excited at times, but they're class, yeah.
Thank you, Charlie.
Cheers, Jack. Thanks a million.
Joined by the co-captains, Dermot McGann and David Beery. Boys, how does it feel? Dermot, I'm going to come to you first because you said nothing now.
I'm a man of few words. I can't put it into words, the feeling from it. Like, it's just, there's a lot of relief as well, like, coming down the last few years. Like, we've always said we have such a good team on paper and this, and it never really clicked, but this year it has clicked for us, and I don't think I can put it into words at the minute yet. It'll be tomorrow when I can say what that really means.
And for the two of you as co-captains, you've come up all the way through playing underage football together and all that. It's a special thing.
Oh yeah, it is a special thing. Like there's a fair group of us there now that came up together, and even the younger lads coming in there now, like David's brother and Shane, the nephew, like, it's just, there's a lot of brothers and relations on the team, so it makes it a bit more special as well at the end of the day.
Yeah. And when I think back, one of my earliest memories with ye involved would have been actually defeating Boyle in an under 16 Division 1. I was thinking about that the whole time. I was like, these boys know how to beat Boyle. David, anything, like, do you think back on all these things when the lead up, what was going through your head in the lead up to?
Yeah, I suppose, like, it's not really, they're not really a team. I won't say that we don't, like, we knew they were good players, but like you said, we've played them. I think our first final against them was probably Keenan Cup.
Probably, yeah.
About 2006, I think, like, and we've always had a bit of a rivalry there with them underage, like, so it's, like you said, we know we were well able to match them. It was just about showing that at senior level now. I think we played them maybe two or three times in senior, and they probably had got the better of us. But
they knocked us out in the quarterfinal,
yeah,
didn't they?
A couple of years ago in the hide. And it was just about, like Jeremy said, it was just about a clicking today. And look, there was mistakes made, but I think the last score really epitomised what we were trying to do all year, where, you know, we got a short kick out off, worked it down the field, quick ball in, and Tony finished it with a great score. So everything that we were kind of working on, I think it was showed in that last score.
Yeah, absolutely. Everyone talks about moments, and is there any other moments from the game that you can remember that come to mind? Any obscure moments?
Jeremy missing a 13-yard free.
Thank fuck we got another chance anyway. Thank God we got another chance there. No, I suppose even, like, Collins catch when he was down on the fucking ground in the first half, from his mark to, I think it was Enda, he just assessed that if Enda got away from him, we could have been in trouble there as well, like. Some of them sort of moments there,
yeah,
as well.
I think even when Paddy got injured, I think it was kind of, we had worked really hard. I think Murph showed Enda was running down the wing, and Murph kind of showed him inside. Myself and Timmy managed to get a stop on him, and then Paddy picked up the loose ball and that's kind of where he got injured, but it was that kind of work rate throughout that really, I think there was little moments like that that kind of add up when you're getting turnovers on the likes of Inda and that they're kind of things that you can draw on to kind of drive you on.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think, like, say, as I say, Paddy be such a driving force, as much as we don't like to admit it to him on the field. And then Kev as well in the last two games have been, Kev dragged us over the line, yeah. Really, like, so when you think of that, like, did it give you the spur to...
Oh, it did, like, you don't want, like, for Kev there, like, what he was doing for the team, like, he was getting up on 8 to 10 tackles a game, like, for a wing forward, like, I think that's unreal, and it gives us some lift then when he overturns the ball. And but then at the end of the day, we wanted to win that for them then. That drove us on as well. Like, you want to give him another chance to get back into a Connacht semi-final, what it is now, so we've given him that chance.
Yeah, definitely, just what Jeremy said there. Like the two boys have been a massive part, especially the quarter-final and semi-final, so it was definitely an extra kind of spur on there to win it for them.
And you're going to enjoy the celebrations now?
Yeah, a week long.
how many days have you booked off in Dublin?
I've two booked off, but we might see, can we get a 6 hour for the rest of the week?
COVID.
COVID.
Cheers.